The people of the Camargue love their bulls, and they love the game with the bulls. An old razzateur once put it like this: the sight of the black bulls lights a fire in our hearts. They've been part of us since time immemorial. So, the course Camarguez is the essence of our cultural heritage. It's only through the wild bulls of the Camargue that we feel in harmony with the rhythm of tradition.
Black capitalists to make sure that our country is changed for the better.
On the cutting edge, South Africa's radical new plan to transfer the country's wealth into the hands of its true majority.
Black economic empowerment is about access to skills, access to capital.
Our business is about selling dreams.
Across the country, lottery lines are replacing employment lines.
10,000 new jobs have been created from an ethnicity and racial perspective.
While the government has done certain good things, it is not enough. The reality on the ground is that 20 million people live in poverty.
Black economic empowerment and the road to riches, 8:30 tonight.
Culture Smart, a series of traveler's guides to customs and culture around the world. Now there are 6 new titles to add to this series. 6 new pocket-sized books containing comprehensive historical and political backgrounds, cultural insights for business and pleasure, light-hearted do's and don'ts, as well as tips on avoiding culture shock. Look for the Culture Smart series at Dybbuk's, bookstores, online or by phone order.
Thank you. This is the very first record I ever made.
The truly unique singer-songwriter, Roy Orbison.
I close my eyes.
I wrote Pretty Woman, and that took about 30 minutes.
Woman, down the
and all the good ones don't take
it. Eigenlijk helemaal geen nadere aanduiding behoeft. Roy Orbison.
His voice mesmerized audiences around the world, become spellbound. Roy Orbison's greatest hits, 7 o'clock Wednesday. From 1804 to 2004. If Johann Strauss Sr. was alive today, he'd be celebrating his upcoming 200th birthday. And if he was in Australia instead of Austria, he'd be watching SBS's live coverage from his hometown Vienna on New Year's Day. Join the much younger Nim Kim, who will host the 2004 New Year's Day concert live from 9:15 Thursday. No matter what direction you happen to be heading in life, up and away, down and out, or just to the end of your tether, whether it's a girl's night out, a boy's night in, getting down to it or getting out for the one last fling, life is full of surprises, pleasant and not so.
What are you doing? Just making certain.
Can I take it this way? so sorry. Can you see?
Life's just a bowl of popcorn, really. 8:30, Friday.
Twitch, and you're a dead man.
Sunday night.
In 1977, my five-year-old brother and his classmates were interviewed for an Australian Tonight Show.
It's always fun to look at the world through children's eyes.
What do you want to be when you grow up, Jonathan?
A pilot.
A few regrets about education.
What do you want to be when you grow up?
A newsreader.
A newsreader?
25 years later, now in their 30s, they're together again. Sadly, my brother couldn't be here.
Hi, what's your name?
Julius.
They diagnosed him as schizophrenic and they told him he was schizophrenic. It was clearly just descending into depression.
He never had children, found his passion or made his own home.
Looking back in Prep for Life on Inside Australia, 7 o'clock Sunday.
The Western is the only film genre native to America, rooted in its history and landscape, but it was the first to achieve immense popularity worldwide. Its stories were based on the cowboys who followed the cattle trails, the wars with the Indians, and the struggles to impose law and order on the frontier. From the very earliest silent Westerns a century ago, the genre has been based on confrontation. The good guy versus the bad guy, who was finished off in a gunfight in the last reel. Yet the form would become more questioning after the Second World War. More ambivalent about violence, more ambiguous about who the good guys really were.
Just a day, son of a bitch!
In the 60s, the Italians reinvented the genre, creating the spaghetti western. While bandits became heroes and directors tried to tear away the mythology of the West, revealing the brutality and complexity behind the romantic vision of earlier films.
One of the good things about playing westerns, the reason I liked to play westerns was you got to play a really bad guy. You know, really nasty.
To this day, whenever America is threatened, or feels itself to be threatened, our politicians will often drop into, I think unconsciously, drop into a kind of Gary Cooper, John Wayne mode.
Of course, if you really investigate how the West was won, it was slaughter. We went in and murdered a lot of people, Indians, and took over the land. I don't know if they really investigated that.
The first Western to achieve renown was the Great Train Robbery of 1903, but many of the traditional Western elements were already present. A robbery by gunmen, a chase on horseback, and a final shootout. Many of these early silent Westerns also drew on the stories of Indian attacks, and the director Thomas Ince even featured a troop of genuine Indians in his films.
A lot of silent Westerns are about the vanishing American, i.e. the Native American. And there's a lot of films that actually take the side of the Indian, the American Indian. For example, versions of Ramona, which was a novel written in the 1880s. There's various versions of Ramona, the famous song that was reissued in the 60s, which is all about a lament for the decline of a great civilization.
The idea that there is some uniformly dismissive or racist attitude towards the Indian as reflected in Hollywood Westerns is not in and of itself, I think, accurate. There are too many noticeable exceptions. In films like The Vanishing American, it's all about Indians. You know, they are the central character, and they're very sympathetically portrayed. That's 1926. The West was only 30 years ago in these movies. I mean, if you think about it, the West then was like 1970 is to us. It's not a long ways away.
Films like John Ford's The Iron Horse, or James Cruise's The Covered Wagon, or The Big Trail, which are doing a sort of epic story of the journey across America, and a lot of the actual participants are still alive, just. So they actually appear in the movies sometimes. I mean, Wyatt Earp appeared in the movies.
Wyatt Earp was living in Southern California, and all you had to do was ring him up on the phone, and he'd come down and tell you how, you know, men really used guns. It was all right there.
By the 1930s, the Western had chiefly become the province of B-movie directors, using formulaic plots and shooting on low budgets. But the greatest of all Western directors was to revolutionize the genre. John Ford's Stagecoach is regarded by many as the classic Western. Released in 1939, the story of a stagecoach journey through hostile Indian territory was in some ways typical of the early Westerns. The Indians were a faceless, uncharacterized menace, and the film provided the chases and final gunfight expected by its audience. But it also added a more sophisticated portrayal of Western society.
I think it harks back to the silent Westerns in the sense that these people are almost like archetypes, and archetypes that he had dealt with in the silent era, like, you know, the drunk doctor, the timid salesman, the crooked politician, the good bad man, the good bad girl, the society lady, the southern gentleman. All of these are cliche, you could say stereotypes, or you could call them archetypes. Ford made them into archetypes if they weren't before.
Society's outcasts are the ones who do the hard work of society, not the bankers, not the presidents, not the people that get their name in the newspapers. It's a whore, it's a drunken doctor, it's a gambler, it's an escaped convict. These are the people who band together. These are the strength of America.
Haven't I any right to live? What have I done?
We're the victims of a foul disease called social prejudice, my child. These dear ladies of the Law and Order League are scouring out the dregs of the town. Come on. They're proud, glorified dreg like me.
You get going, Doc, you're drunk.
Stagecoach is valuable, aside from its implicit qualities as a movie, in two areas. I think it establishes the mythology of John Wayne. And I think it establishes the mythology of Monument Valley, both almost with a thunderclap.
Well, Duke Wayne was extraordinarily good-looking and very tall and a real hunk. I mean, 6'4". Football player, lean, well-built, good face, good walk, which he'd worked on.
John Wayne had been around since 1930, starring in movies. And Ford set him up so that audiences could see him as if it was the very first time. His introduction, Ford tracks in very rapidly onto John Wayne's face.
Hold it!
Whoa, steady, ho, ho.
Now, that's not a typical John Ford camera movement. John Ford did that camera movement very few times in his entire career.
I don't think he thought he could act that much, but he didn't think he was a great actor, but he had a real star quality, which Ford knew exactly how to deal with.
And John Ford was very simple, photographed brilliantly. I mean, his choice of locations was wonderful. You know, he always, oh, geez, where is that? Monument Valley, the Arches, you know, the Moab. All of those beautiful countryside.
Monument Valley had been there for thousands of years. It had even been used tangentially in a film or two, The Vanishing American and The Silent Days, the Zane Grey films. But it had never had the care lavished on it that Ford lavished on it. Ford adored the place. He loved its isolation. He loved its solitude. The impact. impact of Monument Valley in Stagecoach is to just set the context of the Stagecoach being a tiny little dot in this vast lunar expanse that nobody had ever really seen clearly before.
I think that Stagecoach is an example of the romanticizing the West in the sense that the hero is a little bit of a superhero. He's able to do heroic things and perform deeds that are beyond the scope of anybody but a great stuntman like Yakima Canutt.
One major factor in Stagecoach's success was its brilliant action sequences, especially the 10-minute scene in which the Stagecoach is chased by Indians. John Ford employed Yakima Canutt, perhaps Hollywood's greatest ever stuntman, whose work in the film became legendary.
Well, he had about the best stuntman. It was Yakima Canutt, and who did that stunt under the Stagecoach, which had never been done before. But I think again, Ford was going for a great movie.
I've seen him do it in two or three different pictures other than Stagecoach. You jump out of the seat, you go down onto the wheelers, the swing, and the lead team, and in some cases he's shot off and he goes under the whole team. If you ever look down between the horses, there's not much room.
He had done similar stunts at Republic, I believe, a couple of years before. It was not the first time that he'd done that trick, but it was the first time anybody had seen it well shot, well framed, well built up to.
Well, the old Westerns, they were all stunts. It was, I think, much more important than the acting. You can remember things you've seen done in some of the old Westerns, and you can't even remember who starred in it.
It's an amazing structural achievement, because after spending 10 minutes with this very exciting race between the Indians and the Stagecoach on the dry lake, he then has another confrontation immediately following. There's John Wayne against three guys. The gunfight is, again, paradigmatic in almost every Western. Shots are going to be fired, people will die. You have a hard time, I think, finding five Westerns where there's not gunshots fired.
George Stevens' film, Shane, released in 1953, became one of the first Westerns to explore the nature of violence in its tale of a gunfighter forced to help a group of farmers to defeat oppressive ranchers.
Shane is similar to John Ford's films in some ways, dissimilar in others. The emphasis on landscape is certainly something that Stevens was taking from Ford.
I remember going up the first time looking for locations and people driving out in cars, and Dad would get out and he'd walk and walk and walk. He had a strong concept of the lenses he would use in shooting Shane. And if you notice the scenes that play in front of the Tetons loom so tall. And it was because he'd set the camera back from the actors and use a 100-millimeter lens and draw the Tetons up.
Stevens was such a painstaking filmmaker. I knew a man who was a front office executive at Paramount when Shane was made. And he said that after 5 days of location shooting, Stevens was 4 days behind schedule, and the front office was going absolutely berserk, because this was their worst nightmare. A painstaking, perfectionist director on location.
Shane, wonderful movie, yeah. Jack Palance was really bad, you know.
Jack Palance was inspired casting, and he was a man who'd never been in the West. And I remember when he came out and arrived, and he had that extraordinary face, and he was a rather, almost menacing-looking man, even in real life.
Stevens is taking very classic archetypes. I mean, Jack Palance, the bad, this satanic looking bad guy, dressed completely in black, with a kind of slow, evil grin. you know. And Alan Ladd, this blonde, very beautiful still at that point in his career, much more vulnerable seeming agent of good.
Shane had a very well-structured screenplay. They worked hard on it, and the screenplay was pretty much shot as it was written. And it had a device of Shane coming and the being thought to be the protector of these people. And then a couple of the fellas saw him in town when the Ben Johnson character kind of buffaloes him.
Have some of this. Smell like a man.
Ben Johnson was a real Western guy. He was a rodeo rider, a Western person who John Ford brought into the movies. And there's something so authentic about Ben Johnson when he derides and belittles Shane and calls him Sody Pop, setting up a conflict that's going to work throughout the rest of the picture.
Now, you and your Sody Pop, get out of here and stay out of here.
Shane is a gunfighter. He's a killer. What's a gunfighter do? He kills people. He's fast. He's very fast. He tries to put his guns away, but one damn thing keeps happening after another, and he's got to pull the guns back out because he's got to protect these people because they can't protect themselves. They don't have his professional skill.
You're a low-down lying Yankee. Prove it. North or...
The most famous moment in Shane, non-involving Alan Ladd, is the death of Elisha Cook, where Jack Palance guns him down in cold blood.
He had the crew dig under the muddy water and put a mattress. And this was the first time this was done. He put a leather belt around Elisha Cook Jr. under his clothing and had two wires coming from the back of it. And so with the mattress under the mud, they played the scene. And when Palance shot Torrey, there were two of the biggest grips on the picture holding this wooden rod attached to the wire, and they yanked Torrey back and he fell, you know, into the mud.
That had never been done before. Nothing like that had ever been done in a Western. That in-your-face result of violence had never been shown.
He had come back from the war, and you know, he'd seen men killed and shot and fall, and he'd seen what a .45 does to the human form.
Like many Hollywood filmmakers, George Stevens was involved in active service during the Second World War, even helping to liberate Dachau concentration camp. His experiences revolutionized the way that he filmed violence, bringing a greater degree of realism to the confrontations in Shane.
All of that was, you know, a tremendous change of life for a young man who'd grown up in San Francisco and been the cameraman for Laurel and Hardy and become a movie director. And suddenly for 3.5 years, day by day, you're a military man. And he came back and hadn't seen a movie in 3 or 4 years, and he started seeing Westerns, and people would shoot and fall forward and get up and start shooting some more. And I think one idea he had was to really demonstrate the power of a single bullet on a human being.
In the final confrontation between Alan Ladd, he sees a man up on the balcony and ducks and shoots, and the man teeters and falls through a guardrail and a table and onto the floor, exactly like a pole-axe steer, just dead meat.
Shane, look out!
These are not sequences Stevens would have shot in 1939. These are not sequences Stevens would have thought of shooting, because he hadn't seen what death really is and how final death really is. And that experience of World War II, I believe, radicalized him. And by inserting that realistic violence into Shane. He essentially inserted the leading edge of reality into the Western genre.
Shane's exploration of violence was to have great influence on the Western as a whole, but it was particularly revered in Japan. Here, Westerns were incredibly popular and influential upon the samurai movies of directors such as Akira Kurosawa.
It's a very interesting story, the relationship between Kurosawa and the Western, because when Kurosawa made The Seven Samurai in the 1950s, it was his homage to the films of John Ford and George Stevens's film Shane, which was incredibly popular in Japan.
Kurosawa, along with everybody else, saw a lot of Westerns. And every time he had a chance, when people would ask him who his favorite director was, he would always say John Ford.
So Europe から帰ってきてね、そして宝物を見せるっていうのは、大きくジョン・フォードの写真、サングラスにハンチング、いいだろうってわけで、そして親愛なるアキラ・クロサワへってサインまでしてもらって子供みたいですよ。銀座でね、こういうハンチング作るとかあるってから探してくれって僕が探したんですよ。それまでは日本でいう登山帽でした。黒沢さんのトレードマークはね、それがハンチングになったんです。とにかく、ハンチングにサングラス、これはもう完全にジョン・フォードの真似ですよ。うん、それで喜んでたからね、その帽子は僕が探しに行ったんですよ。
Well, he always said that he was influenced by Ford and the form, I guess, of the Western. But the interesting thing was the samurai. I mean, he brought the samurai into existence in the world of cinema.
The Seven Samurai is the most famous of the samurai films of Kurosawa. Here, the lone gunfighter of the Western is transformed into seven samurai warriors. He was influenced by John Ford, but worked on an epic scale, with the seven samurai defending a village against a gang of bandits. Kurosawa was to radically influence American directors, with a number of his films being adapted into Westerns.
We have a whole genre of American films which are based on Kurosawa films. The Magnificent Seven might be the most successful, mainly because the myth is the most strongest myth. You got these seven guys who are going out for a good deed, and they got screwed.
ハリウッドの荒野の七人にはただ拳銃使いがパンパンパン、あれはヤクザ、それで非常に僕はがっかりして、で帰るに黒沢さんももうこうなっちゃって、おかしいよ、俺の映画と全く違うんだもんねって。でもあれはあれで娯楽としていいけども。
I met Kurosawa in Japan a couple of times. And I asked him, I said, well, he said, I asked him, how what did you think of The Magnificent Seven? He said, I wish my film had made as much money as yours did.
The post-war Western had begun to run out of steam by 1960, as stars such as John Wayne and James Stewart were becoming outmoded. When the director John Sturges adapted Kurosawa's The Seven Samurai into The Magnificent Seven, he produced two innovations that revitalized the genre. Firstly, he set the story in Mexico rather than the Midwest of the classic Western. Secondly, he introduced a gang of young, relatively unknown actors into the genre.
It was rejuvenating, trying to rejuvenate the Western by grooming, you know, some new stars who could perhaps take over from the Waynes and the Stewarts and the Randolph Scotts.
When Sturges was casting this thing, I came to see him, and he said, "Yeah, yeah, Jim, he got the big thick glasses on. Yeah, yeah, Jim, okay, yeah, you're in the movie. I don't know where you're going to be yet. This one of the seven." I said, "What point is that? Is that Britt, the man with the knife?" And he says, "Yeah, that's the one." I said, "That's the one I want to play, man." And he said, "Well." Oh, well, well, let's see, I'll give you a ring around, you know. And he called me up, 3 o'clock, said, come over, pick up your knives.
I think I ran into Jimmy Coburn or something. I said, you know, they're casting over here for The Magnificent Seven. And Jimmy was an old friend of mine. We went to college together in the early 50s in Los Angeles City College. And, of course, Jim went in, and he got it. And I think he had, I don't know, 9 words or something in the picture, but everybody remembers him vividly from the picture, and really was a huge start for his career.
The character was based on that single-minded directness. The knife, the great blade.
Each of them has a particular contribution to make to the team effort. You know, it's like making a movie, actually. And that was an unusual thing in the Western. You know, instead of an all-seeing, all-powerful hero, they're little bits of hero, and you put them all together and you get the Magnificent Seven. They fought like 700. And Eli Wallach has a wonderful, wonderful Mexican baddie.
Generosity. That was my first mistake. I leave these people a little bit extra and they hire these men to make trouble.
Calvera was the name of my character. You understood his plight. He said, I have men to feed, I have responsibilities, and this is one way I do it. I go from village to village to village in order to take care of my men.
I'm going into the hills for the winter. Where am I going to get the food for my men?
Buy it or grow it.
Or maybe even work for it.
Seven. Somehow I don't think you've solved my problem.
It has this theme of the powerless peons in Mexico, robber bandits sort of destroying their livelihood at every harvest time, and they can't quite look after themselves. They need help.
We kind of take on a moral stance here of helping these poor people out with our craft, our ability to kill. And if we kill somebody better than we are, then we're okay.
They come together to do the right thing. Why do they do this? They're not sure. They even talk about, why are we doing this? Why are we risking our lives for these Mexican peasants?
Eli Wallach says, you came back. Why? It's a very good question. Because they're coming back because in the end, they're noble American gunfighters. They're not mercenaries after all. That's what marks it out as an American Western.
You came back for a place like this. Why? A man like you. Why?
When we were filming, we thought this is going to be a real bummer. We have no script. We've got a Japanese story that doesn't necessarily appeal to Americans, we thought, and we've got a Mongolian guy from Brooklyn playing American cowboy named Yul Brynner. We said this is going to be really bad. And I was told that after Casablanca, it's the most oft-played American film on American television. Casablanca is first.
I think The Magnificent Seven is the crucible of all 60s American Westerns, apart from the Italian influence, you know, that Peckinpah's in there. Even what John Wayne was going to do in the late 60s is in there, when he went off to Durango and did all these Mexican things. So it's a very, very influential film, and in Europe particularly.
It was a big hit, The Magnificent Seven. It plays every other month in America. But I loved it. The music. People whistle the music when I walk by now sometimes.
While Kurosawa was inspiring developments in the American Western, his film Yojimbo was also the source for the first internationally successful Italian Western, A Fistful of Dollars, in 1964. Its director, Sergio Leone, reinvented the whole genre, creating the so-called spaghetti Western.
In the arts, everything is interchangeable. And it's quite nice to take from one culture to another. When I made one for Leone, he'd been sued by the Japanese. He had taken a film called Yojimbo and did it frame by frame by frame from the Japanese. He only made it an American Western with Clint Eastwood.
A Fistful of Dollars is Yojimbo done over again, right down to shot sequences identical. So identical that Toho sued the Fistful of Dollars people and won for plagiarism.
Leone grew up as a young boy in Italy, watching the American Westerns. And that's all, he really wanted to do that. He apprenticed for a while with Federico Fellini, who was on the set and worked with him. And he thought, I will bring an approach to it, to the West, a little different from the American. I'll bring the Italian flavor.
It's just his whole world that he created. There's something really, really special about, and there's only been a few filmmakers to do it, to go into like an old genre, all right, as old as you can possibly get, and to really create something that had never been before, all right, which is what he did with the spaghetti westerns.
When I first saw him, the agent said, he wants you to do an Italian western. I said, what's that? He said, it's a spaghetti western. I said, that's like Hawaiian pizza. I don't know, how do you do that? He said, I met Leone, he said, would you like to see just the credits of my first movie? And I went to a little studio and he showed me. And his name came up on the credits and a gun shot off and knocked each letter of his name down. I said, where do you want me to go? He said, I want you in Rome on such and such a day. And I went.
Leone didn't want too much talk in the Western. Cynics might say that's because the films were dubbed into different languages and there are about 10 different nationalities on the set. But I genuinely think he wanted to bring back action, directness, physical activity in movies, and not too much psychoanalyzing people's motives.
There's really no characters. They're kind of sardonic, ironic killing machines.
He also created one of, you know, the greatest screen icons in the history of cinema in the term of Clint Eastwood. He actually is the only director to really, you know, compete with Ford when it came to, you know, creating his own icon. He created the actor to finally replace John Wayne.
What do you mean?
I mean, our partnership is untied. Oh, no.
Wait.
Not you. You remain tied. I'll keep the money and you can have the role.
I think Eastwood is the origin of the modern cinematic hero. You know, I'm afraid, I hate to lay this at Leone's door, but, you know, the Schwarzeneggers, the Bruce Willises, the Charles Bronsons, all those, the Van Dammes, all those style heroes that emerged afterwards begin with Clint Eastwood in Fistful of Dollars. It's Italian machismo meets American style.
He, you know, more or less kind of created even the spillover of the spaghetti westerns into just American westerns with the bad good guy and or the anti-hero and the levels of violence and the ambiguity as far as the good guy and the bad guy was concerned. All that was then later adopted by the American westerns, and that was my time of consciousness.
The Italian westerns made this huge effort to sort of give a shot in the arm to the Western, to give it more energy, to make people believe in it again, and to resemble those movies that they all saw when they were children under Mussolini, when it was sort of forbidden pleasures to go and see the Western. So they rejuvenate it, but in the process they kill it off because they pump it up, they exaggerate it, they have an action climax every 10 minutes, they have lots of emphasis on hardware, lots of brutality, lots of noise. And you reach a sort of point of no return almost with that.
The most influential of Leone's films with Eastwood was The Good, the Bad and the Ugly, also starring Lee Van Cleef and Eli Wallach. Here, Leone's stylistic innovations were taken to an extreme, aided by Ennio Morricone's extraordinary score.
Leone's visual sense was so extravagantly beautiful. It really was comparable to Ford's in almost every respect. You know, even more expansive and even more languid, and Ford didn't have Ennio Morricone. And a great composer in a predominantly visual medium, like the Western, which is not dialogue intensive for the most part, is very important.
Leone always ended his films, the Westerns, either in a circle with a shootout, or music playing, or a clock. All those things were his imprint.
He also takes that grammar of sort of walking towards each other, long shot, medium shot, shot of face, shot of eyes, and takes that glamour and extends it into a mad kind of rhetoric so that each shot lasts twice as long as it ever has before, and he's sort of celebrating in a really extreme way that increasing sort of tension. So long shot, hands, medium shot, face, close-up, 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 and real close-up with the Technicolor screen. So, Technicolor screen, so you've got, you know, Clint Eastwood's eyes, Eli Wallach's eyes, Lee Van Cleef, and you can tell a lot from their eyes because, you know, you can read their character. And he's taking the grammar of the Western and just pumping it up and exaggerating.
To me, one of the most, like, wildly, like, in particularly crushing weird things in the history of cinema is after going through this incredible journey in The Good and the Bad and the Ugly, where we've fallen in love with Eastwood and we've fallen in love with Wallach, and we just have to assume that they've committed some bond with each other, that they would still screw each other over at the end. You actually think that he might just hang Tuco at the end of the movie, and it's so crushing. Can't you guys feel towards each other the way we feel towards you? And where in movie would you do a 3-hour epic where there really is no bond by these guys, no matter what they've gone through at the end? There's a beauty in that.
Leone's iconoclastic take on the Western was a hit with the rebellious 60s generation. By the end of the decade, the Vietnam War had started, and the old heroes were seen as suspect. Instead, Western leads became anti-heroes, like the bank-robbing outlaws in Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
Well, I was reading stuff in the late 50s, and I came across their story, which was unknown at that time. There was very little written about them at that time, but what appealed to me was the two men becoming legends again. Scott Fitzgerald, one of our great writers, said there are no second acts in American lives. And what appealed to me was that they went to South America, they were driven out, and they did it again, and they lived down there for all those years until they died.
I know that I read the script on my way to London and called the agent, who was my agent, and said, "You gotta get this for me." And the agent, a very wonderful guy named Evert Ziegler, said, "Well, there's a lot of other bidding for this." I said, "Get it, or else. And at that time, I was able to exercise a certain amount of pressure. And we got it.
I think the element of humor that ran throughout that movie plays a big part as to why people like these guys. They were very charming. They were kind of scoundrels. It was sort of a Robin Hood sort of thing in a way. Not that they were giving the money to the poor, but they were fighting against the railroad, a big entity that was cold-hearted, and these guys had loads of heart.
They got in trouble. They robbed a lot of trains and banks, and E.H. Harriman, who ran the Union Pacific Railroad, formed a super posse, and something never done before, to kill them. I had no idea if I was writing a traditional or non-traditional or a hip or a buddy or any kind of Western. I was trying to tell a story of these two guys who died without knowing each other's names. At least that was my concept of them. And I just wrote it, hoping the story would hold. There are times when the movie gets very frail. The super posse saves me twice. The first time they appear, they're doing fun and games and raindrops and all that stuff, and then it gets dicey.
Damn it!
I suppose what really makes the movie is the jump off the cliff. Because when that was new, people used to shout and clap and scream and all that stuff.
All right. I'll jump first.
Nope.
Then you jump first.
No, I said.
What's the matter with you?
I can't swim!
I stole that from the greatest movie ever made, which is Gunga Din, in which Cary Grant and Victor McLaughlin and Douglas Fairbanks Jr. jump off a cliff. And I was thrilled and screamed when I was 8.
Oh, shit!
Westerns tend to be based on confrontations. And at this point, it seems normal that they run away. I wrote the entire middle third of the movie is essentially a plot point saying, please go to South America. In other words, I had the super posse chase them and get closer and closer until they jump off the cliff and decide to go, because I didn't want people thinking they were cowards. I wanted them to be happy they were getting out. So, and then the end of it, a lot of it's real. We don't know how they died. I think that's how they died. But a lot of it's pretty much what the Cassidy story was.
We have these two beloved characters, and there they are. They're sitting down, eating a meal, possibly of iguana or chicken. And as they start eating, we begin to see the scene fill up, the soldiers in place. And then it all exploded.
Especially the house, and it's still moving.
I had the notion that if I could get to the ending, it would be terrific if they never talked about their situation. If they talked about Australia and beaches and what they'd done and blah, 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 that was swell. As long as I stayed away from the fact that they were going, that was my moment of stupid courage that I wanted, I wrote in the end of the movie. They never talk about where they are.
They got horses in Australia. Now they got thousands of miles we could hide out in. A good climate, nice beaches. You could learn to swim.
No, swimming isn't important.
You never know anything when you're writing. You never know if you're going to write the next day or if you're going to quit or if it's going to be terrific or awful. But I knew if I could get to that scene, if I could somehow make my story get there, I knew that I would be able to write that scene. And the last shot, which became a famous shot where it freezes and then it bleeds out, that was a very tricky shot in those days. But I think essentially, for whatever reason, audiences took to those two guys. There was a whole mythology at the time, because people were always trying to figure out why is a hit a hit? Because of the Vietnam War then, and the Vietnam War was the super posse, was Vietnam coming to kill all the good young people. I don't know why it was a hit, people liked it. The only reason movies are successes is because people like them, and the only reason they're failures is people don't like them, and everything else is mythology.
I remember seeing at that time some scripts depicting the end of the Old West. And cowboys getting in their automobiles, or ranchers getting in their automobiles, or primitive automobiles, and so on.
The late 60s and 70s saw a flurry of revisionist westerns, such as A Man Called Horse and Soldier Blue, that critically examined the myths of the West, especially the treatment of the Indians. But one director truly made the end of the West his subject, Sam Peckinpah. In films such as The Wild Bunch and Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid, he explored what happened to the figures of the Old West as their way of life was drawing to a close.
Peckinpah consciously doesn't set his movies in 1875 or 1888, where John Ford was setting his movies. Peckinpah is setting his movies around 1900, you know, with the advent of the motor car.
With the car came the death of the West, and that was what fascinated him the most, was that transition from the West, the frontier world, to the modern generation, to the 20th century, to technology, to the car, to the aeroplane. And I think he yearned for the old and didn't like the new.
I think he was trying, and always did try, for the honest West. The honesty behind the people who lived in the West.
That was the magic, I think, of Sam Peckinpah, was able to use that milieu with in the Western setting and make it so believable as a development of a creative idea, a creative vision, really, what he had of the West, because I found out he was raised in the northern part of California and knew a lot about the West and knew what he was talking about and was trying to capture in film.
The Western had always been more or less an inherently optimistic genre, in that the characters went on. In Stagecoach, Ringo and Dallas take the buckboard and go to his spread across the border where the law can't get them. They're going to have a life. They're going to raise a family on his land. Even Shane. Shane's wounded, but he's going over the hill. He may live, he may die. We don't know. But he's moving on, you know? Moving on is the key part of the Western myth. And that's also a key part of the American myth, that you can, if things don't work out one place, they may work out another. And you can reinvent yourself. You can become whatever you want yourself to be. That's a very American idea. Peckinpah, everybody dies and the vultures arrive to pick the bones.
After Peckinpah, the Western sunk into decline during the 70s and 80s. However, Clint Eastwood continued to both direct and star in Westerns, and in 1992, he released an extraordinary revisionist Western, Unforgiven. Eastwood's character is a former gunfighter who is recruited to track down two men who have disfigured a prostitute. Unlike his role in the Leone films, here he is an aging, unheroic figure, and the film is a powerful examination of the consequences of violence.
After he came back to America, having made The Good, the Bad and the Ugly in 1967, Eastwood spent a long, long time trying to find an American idiom to use the character of the man with no name in American movies. And it's a fascinating, the whole, I mean, you know, Fistful of Dollars, Josie Wales' Outlaw, Unforgiven is a fascinating riff on this character, this self-sufficient, stylish, rather self-contained character, and then turning him into a human being. And frankly, by the time of Unforgiven, Eastwood was the Western. An entire genre rested on that man's shoulders.
He didn't really have a character in Sergio Leone. They call him the man with no name. In Unforgiven, he does have a character. He's a widower. He's got a couple kids. He's a farmer who can't make a go of it. He used to be a killer. He used to be a gunfighter, and that was how he made his money. And he tried to go clean because of his wife.
The Schofield kid comes in and says to Clint's character, this is what happened with these women. You know, I'm this, you know, tough killer myself. I've heard you're a pretty good killer too. Come help me take care of this situation. You know, resolution, let's resolve this.
The whole plot is triggered by a girl being cut up. And no, that's something you don't do. I'm going to ride halfway across America to put that right. It has a black character, Morgan Freeman, who doesn't hang around for the final shootout, and there's a very interesting relationship between him and the man with no name. They're very at ease with each other. And the violence, this Schofield kid, this young punk, this wimp who thinks he's going to be terribly macho, and in the end absolutely hates shooting people, and it's messy and horrible and so on.
It's a hell of a thing, killing a man. You take away all he's got and all he's ever gonna have.
Yeah. Well, I guess they had it coming.
We all have it coming, kid.
It's such an anti-heroic piece. The people who you think are heroes are not. And people you think aren't have heroic qualities that you don't expect in them. And they're more like human beings. There's shades of gray. There's no black and white in it.
At the end of the film, Eastwood's character, William Money, kills six people in revenge for the death of his friend, Ned. His massacre is witnessed by W.W. Beauchamp, a writer who's mythologized the West and turned its gunfighters into heroes.
He's a character who kind of represents all the bullshit about Westerns and about the mythology of these outlaws and so-called heroic outlaws, who are many of them psychopaths and violent thugs.
The writer of sort of penny dreadfuls and dime novels in the Western has quite a long genealogy, actually. I mean, he's there in The Left-Handed Gun in the 50s, written by Gore Vidal. He's there in Buffalo Bill and the Indians, made by Robert Altman for Bicentennial Year. You know, the mythmaker, Ned Buntline, is wandering around constantly exaggerating what Buffalo Bill's been up to. Give the public what they want, it's the show business. And he's there in Unforgiven. He usually appears in films where it's a sort of signal that this is going to be a meditation on the creation of myths.
This is a guy who made his living, you know, mythologizing the West without knowing anything about it. And so, in a way, it served the purpose really well of a script that was doing exactly that for the Western.
When confronted by superior numbers, an experienced gunfighter will always fire on the best shot first.
Is that so?
Yeah, Little Bill told me that.
And you probably killed him first, didn't you?
I was lucky in the order. But I've always been lucky when it comes to killing folks.
And so, who was next? It was Clyde, right? He must have killed Clyde. Well, it could have been Deputy Andy, wasn't he? Or...
All I can tell you is who's going to be last.
Where does William Money go? He's damned. He's damned himself. He's crossed over into darkness. There's no possible way out for him.
And he just walks out of that saloon, and it's dark and it's raining, and nobody contests him. Is he, you know, riding off into the sunset? No, he's riding off into the cold, wet darkness.
He rides into hell. And I think that's what is so wonderful about it. There's nothing great about what he's done. It's awful what he's doing.
What you get in films of the 60s and 70s, with movies like The Wild Bunch, or later on, Unforgiven, which end in Gauderdammerungs of blood and death, where there's nobody left and no possibility left of redemption, you get a dead end, which is one of the reasons that the Western is essentially a dead genre. In an effort to bring something new to the mix, they nailed the coffin lid shut in the genre.
When I was a kid, I started going to movies in the 30s, if you will, and two of the great genres that were the basis, like special effects movies are and violence movies are, were Westerns and musicals, and now they're both gone.
It's a foundation myth of American society. It can't go. There's never been a body of myth that disappears. It'll reform itself in some way. Well, you could say it's reformed itself as Star Wars, that the Western lives in the zero gravity of space. Yeah? Or it reforms itself as cop movies, post-Dirty Harry. So it still lives in other genres, although it's lost its iconography and its setting and its historical thing.
I mean, the only Western of quality in the last decade has been Eastwood's wonderful Unforgiven.
You can't say Unforgiven is the culmination of all Westerns. I mean, it was, you know, a very good Western of all Westerns anyways, and it has happened to be done most recently.
I hear that people are considering the Western again, just as they're turning to film noir again.
Maybe the Western will come back. It's a great, you know, it's a pure American art form.
Black economic empowerment is about access to skills, access to capital.
From an ethnicity and racial perspective.
The road to riches in South Africa next. Staying in is the new going out this New Year's Eve.
Thank you. This is the very first record I ever made.
Catch the masterful Roy Orbison at 7.
The same procedure as last year, sir.
The same procedure as every year, Jay.
The traditional dinner for one is at 8. Then that fiery flamenco fella, Joaquin Cortez, heats up the evening. Performing live from the Royal Albert Hall at 8:30. And in Rio de Janeiro, a Tai Chi love triangle that squares up a little differently in Bossa Nova at 10. there's a little something for everyone Wednesday night.
Whoops.
Our New Year's Eve on SBS.
Culture Smart, a series of travellers' guides to customs and culture around the world. Now there are six new titles to add to this series. Six new pocket-sized books containing comprehensive historical and political backgrounds, cultural insights for business and pleasure, light-hearted do's and don'ts, as well as tips on avoiding culture shock. Look for the Culture Smart series at Dimmicks, bookstores, online or by phone order.
From 1804 to 2004. If Johann Strauss Sr. was alive today, he'd be celebrating his upcoming 200th birthday. And if he was in Australia instead of Austria, he'd be watching SBS's live coverage from his hometown Vienna on New Year's Day. Join the much younger Nim Kim, who will host the 2004 New Year's Day concert live from 9:15 Thursday. He's a world-infamous pop star. He's sold millions of albums. He has millions of fans. So what does he really think about his job?
I never enjoyed anything about it.
His songs.
All Before I Die, crap. Strong, crap.
His performances.
I can't stand the way I perform. It's like a Tourette's syndrome thing that I've got.
His bad habits.
Today, I really don't feel like a drink.
Ooh, there's someone Robbie shagged.
The paparazzi.
All of them bastards are them f***ing stupid f***ing magazines. I just want to get a baseball bat and smash the faces in.
And himself.
I'm a selfish, self-seeking, self-pitying fool.
So let the real Robbie Williams entertain you. Robbie Williams, Nobody Sunday, 10 o'clock Friday. We've travelled 4 million kilometres, visited 160 countries and learned about the hopes and aspirations of the many diverse and interesting residents in our global village. Global Village, 6 p.m. weeknights.
And he named his men the Iron Chefs, the invincible men of culinary skills.
Saturday night is ripe for a food fight when challengers from all over the world meet the fabulous Iron Chefs in a do-or-die struggle to get super creative with a secret ingredient and 60 minutes. If things get too hot, get out of the kitchen with Iron Chef, 7:30, Saturdays. Sunday night.
In 1977, my five-year-old brother and his classmates were interviewed for an Australian Tonight Show.
It's always fun to look at the world through children's eyes.
What do you want to be when you grow up, Jonathan?
Pilot.
A few regrets about education.
What do you want to be when you grow up?
A newsreader.
A newsreader?
25 years later, now in their 30s, they're together again. Sadly, my brother couldn't be here.
Hi, what's your name?
Julius.
They diagnosed him as schizophrenic and they told him he was schizophrenic. He was clearly just descending into depression.
He never had children, found his passion or made his own home.
Looking back in Prep for Life on Inside Australia, 7 o'clock Sunday. The world is an amazing opportunity, and SBS Language Services can expand your market and reach new audiences by translating websites, brochures, re-narrating and voiceovers, television commercials and documentaries, subtitling, corporate videos and feature films. We can provide interpreters, multicultural talent and cross-cultural consultancy, all in over 60 languages. SBS Language Services makes a world of difference.
I think that went really well.
I think it was great. I loved the first two sketches.
I should get that silver Jaguar.
Is something telling you it's time to get a Jaguar? Presenting the Unleash a Jaguar sales event. Get a 3-litre X-Type for the price of a 2.5. For a limited time only. Unleash one today.
Water. When we want hot water, Mum puts this jug under the water, under the tap, until the water's hot. That way we don't waste any. Then you can use it for watering your plant or whatever. I'm Hayley, and that's Mum, and we're water savers.
Authorised by the Victorian Government, Melbourne.
The fastest way to transfer money worldwide. Western Union Money Transfer.
Available at your participating Australia Post, news agents and other quality outlets.
It's been a long time since transportation has truly advanced. Now, we have good news for planet Earth. The petrol electric Prius is here, with up to 90% less emissions and over 1,000 kilometres per tank, giving us all the power to move forward.
Coming up in SBS World News tonight, aid pours into Iran as the president promises to rebuild. America's plans for armed sky marshals draw flak. Questions over the safety of Australian Army combat uniforms. And safe and sound after 9 days lost in the wilderness. Details at 9:30.
Democratization in South Africa created a totally new business environment. It is a fact that we have to deal with the ills and evils of the past. I believe that we should take responsibility to ensure that transformation happens right across the spectrum, socially, politically, and economically.
I dream of getting paid lots of money, lots of it. The first thing I'd like from the government is a better job so that I can fix up my house.
South Africa is often described as the political miracle of the 20th century, a country that achieved a peaceful transition to majority democratic rule. Almost 10 years after the end of apartheid, the majority of South Africans are still waiting for an economic miracle to transform their lives. Their hopes are pinned on a radical plan, black economic empowerment, to share the nation's wealth and opportunity more fairly. For the millions who suffered under apartheid, it's a change that's long overdue.
We all share a father too, our Father who is in heaven. Hallelujah. Your salvation was prepared especially for you. Your answers are in the salvation.
Humphrey Khoza is one of the new faces of South Africa. Monday through Friday, he is the chief executive officer of a major Johannesburg business. But on Sundays, he is here at his church in the community he grew up in.
This is typical, as it used to be. Those days, this we used to call a cold.
It has been said the DC-3 and C-47, which was the military version, were the most successful aircraft ever built. The faithful Dakota certainly has done some work in over 40 years of flying around the world. In New Zealand, they carried Vivian Leigh and Lord Lawrence Olivier to engagements during the 1948 tour of the Old Vic Company. The specially converted freighter version also carried all the scenery and props. For many years, the DC-3 freighter fleet carried just about anything and everything. The planes carried up to 7,500 pounds each trip and also completely changed the public attitudes to cargo handling.
Imagine committing an act so destructive and terrifying that your name becomes a word for it. From the archives of the History Channel, this is Timelab 2000. For centuries, no city was more glorious than Rome. As the center of the Roman Empire, its very streets and statues, temples, and public places embodied the most beautiful art and architecture of the civilized world. So, when Rome was savagely plundered in 455 AD, it was an event so frightening it burned a new word into our vocabulary. Today, when we are horrified by a wanton act of destruction, we travel back in time to recall the marauders of Rome, who were from a Germanic tribe called the Vandals. For the History Channel, I'm Sam Waterston.
On July 16, 1969, the world held its breath.
It's one small step for man.
History was made. But could the U.S. government have pulled off the greatest deception of the century?
I can't say 100% for sure whether these men walked on the moon.
Using government-issued photos and film footage.
The flag flaps on the moon where there's no atmosphere.
And with the testimony of one former astronaut.
NASA could have covered it up.
Examine the possibility that man has never walked on the moon.
There are always going to be people who believe some outlandish theories.
If you can't make it, fake it.
Conspiracy theory. Did we land on the moon? On the History Channel.
The following program is classified PG. The History Channel advise parental guidance is recommended for persons under 15 years.
During the last 2 months of the Second World War in Europe, the Army Air Force's front line, the P-47 Thunderbolt fighter pilots, were the subject of a unique color film made on the orders of the highest Air Force general, Hap Arnold. 16 Air Force camera crews would live alongside of the pilots, filming their takeoffs and landings, their missions and attacks, their everyday lives and deaths. This is their story in the final and most deadly battles of the war, the conquest of the Reich. In the early spring of 1945, the fighter pilots of the U.S. Army Air Force in Europe were recovering from the biggest battle in U.S. military history, the Battle of the Bulge. Their losses had been enormous in both men and equipment. Replacement pilots and new planes were arriving daily to fill out the depleted ranks. P-47 Thunderbolt fighter groups were operating from captured German Luftwaffe air bases just miles from the front lines with new missions to fly close-in air support for the Army's advance into Germany. The Thunderbolts were some of the fastest and most powerful fighter planes in the world and could reach speeds of nearly 600 miles per hour in a dive. Their pilots were some of the best. 7 out of the top 10 American fighter aces in Europe flew Thunderbolts. They flew without pressure suits, and only strong young men could withstand the forces of gravity built up after a steep dive. They were all tough, well-trained, and their morale was high. In March 1945, Arthur Davis was a replacement pilot assigned to the 362nd Fighter Group based in eastern France near the German border.
They were all about the same age I was in my early 20s, 23, 24, something like that. And there were very few, a couple guys that were almost 30, and we call them grandfather, that sort of thing. But there were fellows younger than I was. The morale was high. As a matter of fact, I was a little surprised because they have always experienced several casualties over a period of time. And I was a replacement for someone who had been killed in action. And I was expecting something other than that, but the morale was very high.
A fighter group had 3 squadrons, each consisting of 16 planes and 25 pilots. Keeping a 48-plane Thunderbolt fighter group flying took long supply lines and the efforts of 75 pilots and 1,200 ground crew personnel, operation officers and meteorologists, radio and radar operators, anti-aircraft gunners, fuel supply and distribution systems, runway construction and maintenance engineers. Each plane in the group required 25 men to keep it flying, and work went on around the clock. The P-47 Thunderbolt was the biggest, heaviest, and most powerful single-engine fighter ever built at the time, considered by its pilots to be almost as tough as a tank and as difficult to destroy. With its 2,400 horsepower engine, it weighed almost 8 tons fully loaded. Every plane carried a motion picture camera in the wing, timed to operate automatically with a gun trigger. Many frontline fighter planes were flying 3 missions a day, and keeping these planes in the air required close coordination between every man in the group. The confidence of the pilots in their ground crew was essential. Any overlooked detail could cost them their lives. 23-year-old Ken Bullock flew 46 combat missions in Thunderbolts during the last months of the war.
You know, there were supposed to be some rules about fraternizing with the enlisted men and all that stuff. That went out the window the minute we joined the squadron. We were all in there together. It didn't matter if you were a private or a colonel. You were all on the same team. You knew each other. I mean, you showed respect, don't get me wrong, but the people really worked together. You talk about cooperation and communication, it was there. And I am so proud to be a part of that.
We liberated a supply dump or something full of Mercedes convertibles. And it turned out that almost every pilot in the 377th had his own convertible.
By March 1945, the mission of the P-47s had changed from bomber escort to close air support for the advancing ground troops and armor. Flying attacks from as low as 50 feet were costing many pilots their lives. A new man joining a Thunderbolt group at this time in the war had a life expectancy of just two missions. Squadron commanding officers had reached the rank of major, having flown over 100 combat missions, many by the age of 24. In the last air battle over Germany, they would lead their men into the cockpits and down the runway. Almost half of these pilots filmed, both veteran and new replacements alike, would be casualties 10 weeks later when the war ended. The coming battle for the Thunderbolts would be over one of the greatest natural defense obstacles in Europe, the Rhine River. No foreign army had crossed the Rhine into Germany in 150 years. The battle would last for 3 weeks. All Thunderbolts were now flying three combat missions a day. 22-year-old Lieutenant Paul Odell was a veteran of 45 combat missions, many of them over the Rhine.
And they would have a crew chief and the assistant there. They would get us up in the plane. Then naturally we had to start the plane up in that area and have the crew chief get on a wing because we had to taxi out over chicken wire and straw, and he had to guide us along because we couldn't weave back and forth to see where we were going. So then we would finally get to the end of the runway, and we'd get lined up in the, you know, we'd get lined up in position, our takeoff position, depending on where we were in the flight. Well, when you're on the flight line, ready to take off, I mean, some things go through your mind. I think my own particular deal, you felt kind of invincible, so you weren't really expecting anything to happen to you. And so it didn't really prey on your mind that much.
The pilots would awake at 3:30 in the morning for the daily briefing. Engines would start at dawn.
And beside the throttle, you had the supercharger. Had to be opened up with it because they give you an extra horsepower to get the thing off the ground, especially if it was loaded, heavily loaded with bombs. Main thought was to keep the plane straight going down the runway and get in the air and go do your job and come back. You didn't think about being killed.
Takeoff is a marvelous feeling because you have full control of over 2,000 horsepower engine. And when you put that throttle to the firewall, we call it, it's all the way forward, you've got all the power you need to take off. And it thrusts you back in your seat hard against the crash pad in the back. And you know that you're going to go up and fly.
The conquest of the Reich was about to begin. Primary target, the Rhine.
Nearly a quarter of a million homosexuals fought for Britain during the Second World War.
I think I did my bit for my country. I can say I was always in action one way or the other.
But today, homosexuality is an offence in the British Armed Forces.
I think most red-blooded males are repelled by the physical genital activities of these people.
What was it like for them to serve their country but lead hidden lives?
They were men who needed a woman. And we were there to supply that.
Does homosexuality compromise military safety and morale?
I never found anyone a coward under fire.
Or is this ban another form of discrimination?
Men don't like taking showers with men who like taking showers with men.
Sex and War, a special presentation on the History Channel.
Chicken. Oh, this is good.
Woohoo! You do.
Enjoy the show.
Are you thinking what I'm thinking?
That sounds pretty good, doesn't it? It's cool.
Roll out the red carpet and celebrate with the stars. Because every week there's a first-class movie premiere screening in your favorite theater.
Welcome home. In a place like this, the magic is all around you.
You got a bit of a ring to it.
I saw your picture.
The big blockbusters, the big stars, and the big Australian movie premieres are all on the big movie connection, Movie One.
Let's just see the movies.
Let's go!
How can I not have seen this?
Ring, you.
Nothing moves you like the movies.
But wait! There's more.
Nothing moves you like Movie One.
It's the final chapter of a British legend.
Okay.
For over 34 years, the crash had remained shrouded in mystery.
You know, it came as a complete and utter shock.
Now Coniston Water yields up its secret.
You simply didn't expect that what did happen was ever going to happen.
Ending a 30-year search.
I've been absolutely determined to find this wreck. It's become something of a personal obsession.
Specials presents The Search for Bluebird on the History Channel.
March 1945. Within a few weeks of having cameras installed in the wings of their planes, America's Thunderbolt fighters would face their biggest strike to date, the Luftwaffe air bases along the Rhine River of Germany.
When you had 16 planes, usually there were three groups of four below, and the top flight was called cover flight. And they usually weren't carrying bombs. They were just there to protect us from enemy aircraft that we may not spot.
You are alone, even though you're a part of a flight of 16 airplanes. You're still alone. You're the master of your own destiny. It's an exhilarating feeling.
The German Luftwaffe waited in the air, desperate to stop the American army at the Rhine. Diving at high speeds from above the Thunderbolt formations, violent dogfights would suddenly begin between planes only 250 yards apart, firing over 100 bullets a second.
I knew when I'd see tracers going from behind my plane in front of me that he was behind me somewhere, and I was bound this wasn't going to happen. And I thought, oh, buddy, you have had it. You picked the wrong guy today. And I'd nail him and then go look for somebody else.
For dogfighting, it is exciting. I could see these planes coming from our right, and I'm hauling to my wing leader to break right, so we both break right at the same time, because you always turn into them. And they were shooting, and that was the first time I realized you could hear their guns inside your cockpit. So that's how close they were.
I just happened to look up in my mirror, and I saw this ME-109 on my tail, and I had 100 hits before I realized that I was even being hit, and I pulled up, almost went into a stall, and that gives you an indication how fast it all happens. And you don't have much time to think about it. You're doing it really to save your life and get out of the gunfire.
In March 1945, General George Patton was driving his Third Army to the Rhine under the cover of smoke in a daring attempt to establish a bridgehead to the east bank of the river. The Rhine had been Germany's natural defense line since Roman times, and Patton was about to attempt what Caesar had accomplished 2,000 years before, but no other general since Napoleon. Another U.S. Army, the 9th, had reached the Rhine 3 weeks before, but all its attempts to establish a permanent bridgehead across the river had failed due to strong Nazi resistance. Patton's plan relied on the Thunderbolts to knock out German resistance in front of his advancing army.
Supporting the Rhine River attack, it got so we would be flying maybe four ship missions and going out, you know, many missions. We would take two, maybe even three missions a day, but we'd be going out and getting whatever targets we could that would stop us from going across the Rhine. Now we'd have a lot of targets, such as a radio station. Other times we would be going in the front line support controllers and attacking targets for them.
And that one town would not surrender, and they announced to the people with loudspeakers, I guess, and mounted on a tank, said they're given 5 minutes to surrender the town, and they never surrendered. And so we worked the town over, and after that, we were finished. You can imagine maybe 50 or 60 airplanes with 50 caliber rockets. That town was leveled. I don't think there was a mouse left.
Without air cover and no place to hide, heavy German tanks proved vulnerable to air strikes. In one 10-day period, over 500 were destroyed by air-to-ground fighter-bomber attacks. Advancing at speeds of over 300 miles per hour and as low as 50 feet off the ground, even individual German soldiers found themselves suddenly under attack by the Thunderbolts. Patton's audacious secret gamble completely surprised the Germans, as well as Eisenhower. Without firing even one artillery round, and under the cover of darkness, his Third Army quietly crossed the Rhine at Oppenheim, south of Frankfurt, reaching the East Bank at 10:30 p.m. on the night of March 22nd. The daring nighttime operation caused only 28 American casualties. The next day, Patton's tanks, troops, and supplies streamed across the once invincible defense line. His fast-moving army spread out and encircled over 200,000 German soldiers, taking them prisoner. Patton then ordered the captured soldiers run through a modern gauntlet in the main square of Frankfurt, as a living symbol of defeat to the German civilians who were forced to watch. But German radar-controlled anti-aircraft flak was taking its toll on the American Air Force. Dozens of Thunderbolts were hit, wounding the pilots and damaging the planes. Landings became as difficult and dangerous as the missions themselves.
So you would simply come down with your flight below the tower, and they would shoot a gun with a green light or red light, and you would peel off one after the other, and you would literally go into a chandelle, which is like going upside down, drop your wheels while you're upside down, and do a tight turn and come in. And usually you try to do it under 1 minute. Now, there was a reason for that. If each pilot did it in 1 minute, you can determine that you have 50 planes, they would be landing in 50 minutes if that worked out correctly.
Fire trucks and ambulances on runway alert waited for the planes to return. With most planes low on fuel and others unable to drop their landing gear due to flak damage, many pilots had to crash land their planes, often with disastrous results from ruptured fuel lines and unexploded bombs and rockets still attached to their damaged planes.
The average life of a fighter pilot was, I believe, about 4 hours as an average. But I think everyone was concerned with the tremendous losses in the pilots. We had an abnormal amount of fatalities. Just analyzing how many pilots we were losing, it wasn't that I gave up hope. I suppose it made me try harder subconsciously, but I just couldn't visualize myself coming back in the United States and stepping off a boat or a plane. I just couldn't picture it in my mind.
You felt badly when one of your squadron mates got shot down, and particularly if you knew he was killed. I mean, you couldn't really dwell on it because that was it and it was gone. You know?
I lost some friends, and we would lose 3 or 4 pilots a week. And it seems like it was always one at a time.
The air battle over the Rhine was the biggest in World War II at that time. On one day alone, March 24th, Allied pilots flew 12,000 combat missions, even more than on D-Day 10 months before.
We sent 8 out, and 1 came back. That was a bad, bad morning. And when the guy pulled up and taxied up, he stood up in the cockpit and emptied his .45 into the cockpit. He never flew again. They took him to the hospital.
The quiet period we had before takeoff on a mission was something that was designed by some flight surgeon somewhere, but it was a very important thing. It was approximately 5 minutes long, and it enabled each and every one of us already strapped into our fighter plane to re-sift and rehash our thinking and calm ourselves down to get ready for the task at hand. The first time I did it, I thought it was rather foolish. Let's get up and go. That was my attitude. Then after experiencing this quiet time once or twice, I realized how important it was. My whole attitude changed in that 5 minutes. And I imagined that it leaked over into the flight crews, the mechanics, the armorers, the other people. And they felt the same thing. It was sort of a feeling of peace, almost, that came across.
The times that you really didn't feel like you wanted to go on a mission, I suppose, is when they would announce at the briefing that we're going to hit an airdrome today, and a lot of pilots would just back out. They'd say they suddenly would be sick or something. Not many, but the pilots that went through an awful lot, and you knew you were going to get hit. It's just not a guess, an assumption. It was an assumption. You were going to get hit, but how severe, you don't know.
On April 16th, an attack by the Thunderbolts and their allied forces would be the darkest day in the Luftwaffe's history. In the month of April 1945, the Thunderbolt squadrons of the 362nd Fighter Group would target the Luftwaffe with devastating results. 24 German aerodromes would be attacked with guns and rockets, often fired from altitudes of only 20 feet above the ground. Their air raids would destroy 270 planes on the ground and another 29 in the air, along with numerous hangars, flak gun emplacements, and fuel tanks. After more than 3 years of war, which had cost thousands of American fighter pilots their lives, the P-47 pilots of the 362nd were offering the German Luftwaffe no quarter. On April 16th, the combined British and U.S. Air Forces would mount one of the largest attacks on the German Luftwaffe. Six 6,000 Allied airplanes targeted 40 aerodromes inside Germany. 2,000 fighter planes would take part in the attack. Their mission, to destroy the Luftwaffe once and for all. The German air bases were heavily defended by radar-controlled anti-aircraft flak guns. Many pilots and their planes would not return from this day's mission. Those that did carried with them a chilling visual record taken by the plane's mounted cameras.
I had been conditioned to actually to hate the German army, the German military. And this was brought about by some schooling in the service, I'm quite sure. Most of it was subliminal type of thing. But I wanted to kill.
It gave you a sense of gratitude when we hit an airdrome, in one sense, because it was payback time. These were the guys that were up there trying to shoot you down, and we had a chance now to put them to sleep. And so in that sense, it was a good feeling.
Peel off, first of all, and dive down toward the target, get the target in my gun sights, and then fire a preliminary quick burst to clear the guns and make sure that everything was working properly. And then when I got close enough, and I used to go as close as I thought I could, and they said they gave it a distance of several yards, but I tried to close a little closer because I realized that although we had 1,800 rounds of ammunition, it went very quickly, and I might need it for something else. So when I got as close as I dared, then I would pull hard on the trigger and give it all it had for about 2 or 3 seconds. That's all that's needed.
Level attack, you would probably come alongside at about 1,000 feet and then peel off down and come straight in on the target. And that's the time you try and get everything leveled up and get the sight on the target and then give them the burst.
At aircraft was one of the things we probably feared because there wasn't much control what we could do about it. And when they would set the guns on you with radar, you could hear it in the headset. It would go bzzz, 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 like that. You could hear it, and you knew that there was a dish down there that locked you in and they were getting ready to shoot.
At the end of the day, 905 German aircraft and 40 aerodromes were destroyed. The Allied air forces ruled the skies over Germany. Unopposed in the air, the Thunderbolts would now rampage over the country.
A disorder which in many parts of the world people with epilepsy were being burned at the stake.
And then we'll support the area around the valve with a band.
How do you protect the public's health at the same time as you protect civil liberties?
The medical establishment considered the transplantation of tissues and organs from one person to an unrelated other person was going to be impossible.
Medicine Month on the History Channel.
Music so much, it's like three quarters of my life. We first heard about subscription TV through some friends. It's awesome to have a channel just totally devoted to music. It's a really good way to get to know bands. It's a really good way to see bands play live. You can rock out to it, you can chill to it. I don't think I could live without subscription TV anymore. It's just great to have it 24/7, just music, music, music. Nice.
In the last few moments, what's happened in your world?
News on the hour. Headlines every 15 minutes. Breaking news as it happens. Sky News.
When a model of morality...
It's a great time in the history of this country, the Hoover years.
...becomes a bastion of hypocrisy.
One of the most evil men this America has ever produced.
Those on the trail of truth always get their man.
What a dreadful man.
An investigation of the man who ruled the FBI with an iron fist for 48 years.
Has exerted a great influence for good.
Specials presents J. Edgar Hoover on the History Channel.
On April 16, 1945, the Thunderbolt fighter group and the combined Allied forces had scored a major victory over Germany's Luftwaffe. With the front lines now moving quickly eastward, driven by tanks and infantry, the Thunderbolts were ordered to move with them. Captured aerodromes inside Germany were to be repaired and used as forward air bases of operation. When the Air Corps engineers arrived at Frankfurt to inspect an aerodrome, they were confronted with the damage that had been inflicted. What little was left undamaged by the Thunderbolt attacks had been destroyed by the Germans themselves, obeying Hitler's scorched earth policy throughout Germany. If the Allies overran the Fatherland, promised the Führer, they would inherit a wasteland. Luftwaffe planes were found destroyed by the dozens, crushed on the ground. Hangars, barracks, and supply quarters were still smoldering from recent air raids. The once powerful German Luftwaffe, which had struck terror into the hearts of people all over Europe for 6 years, was now a smoldering hulk of its former invincibility. Starved of fuel and spare parts, its famous fighter aces dead or captured. In 6 years of war, over 94,000 Luftwaffe planes had been lost, and with them, over 138,000 airmen. Runways and hangars were quickly repaired. The 362nd Fighter Group moved to their new forward air base at Frankfurt, their fourth in 10 months. From here, their Thunderbolts would rampage over Germany for the next 18 days, attacking anything that moved. The final misery of Germany was about to begin.
There wasn't exactly a fear of not coming back. We realized it was the possibility, definitely was there. But your job was to get the target we were assigned and be sure that your wingman, or if you were the wingman or the element leader or flight leader, took care of each other and to be sure you got back. That was our mission, destroy the target and get back.
Finding targets of opportunity was the order of the day. Flying low to the ground over cities and countryside, Thunderbolt pilots would suddenly dive down on their unsuspecting targets, unleashing their 850 caliber machine guns, bombs, and rockets. For the German army, there would be no place to hide.
You could see the whites of their eyes, so to speak. Whether it was troops or people on motorcycles or trucks or freight cars full of ammunition or whatever. You could very quickly see what you had to shoot at.
So anytime we saw a train, first guy down got to shoot the engine, the locomotive. And you could tell if you got a good hit because all the steam would come up from it and the train would stop. Then you would pick at it car to car. Everyone would take turns until you just about set the whole chain on fire.
Many of those targets were horse-drawn vehicles being tethered by women. Those wagons were full of ammunition, and you start up your pattern, and it was a repeat pattern. You'd keep making pass after pass, regroup, start passing again, and you'd end up with 20, 30 horse-drawn vehicles splattered all over the road, and you'd watch the horses go flying 20 feet in the air when those 50 caliber bullets hit. It was just awesome, the power behind those bullets, that, and the roads would be actually red with blood. You did your job, but you didn't quite feel so great about it.
Coming along, I happened to look down, and there was a bridge that looked like a viaduct, an old Roman viaduct bridge in a way, and it had a truck on top of it. So I thought I'd just shoot the rocket at that. And then after I started down, I thought, well, I might as well salvo all four of them. So I let all four go and pulled up, because you don't see the rockets hit on the way down. And as I pulled up and turned around to see if I'd hit, well, the whole bridge was gone and the truck as well.
I wouldn't start a dive bomb in no less than 8 or maybe 10 or 12,000. The reason being, you come straight down with the aircraft. You release your bombs while you're in that vertical position. And then when they go, then the main thing you should do is get out. Get out of the way. The tanks were very tough. The Tiger tanks they had were really good. And they all carried, or most of them carried, a fuel tank behind them in a trailer. So what we would do is not worry about the tank. We'd hit the trailer and set it on fire. And if it came loose or whatever, then we would shoot the bullets right underneath the tank, and they'd bounce up on from the ground or whatever row they were on or whatever up into inside the tank, because they weren't armor plated underneath, but they were on top and on the sides. So we still found a way to get in.
We used napalm several times, and it was very effective. One of the places where we could use napalm to full efficiency was dropping a load of napalm on top of a Panzer tank. If the hatch was open, of course, you can imagine what would happen. If the hatch was closed, the napalm would spread all over and immediately catch fire, and it would be like having meat in an oven. They would be roasted inside.
You become part of the airplane. It's like putting the airplane on like you would a jacket when you get in it. You wear the airplane and you become part of it, and your pushing of the rudder and the throttle and the stick, it's all automatic, just like when you walk. You're just one leg ahead of the other one. You don't say, I'm going to push this, I'm going to do that. You just do it.
We had many times where pilots were missing. That would be the time that you would dread the most, when you'd get back into echelon for landing and there'd be one plane or two planes missing. It just stayed with you for quite a while. I never thought I'd return back home alive as a pilot. It just never occurred to me that I would. In fact, I had premonition that I would never come back. I just didn't think I'd make it.
On
On May 1st, 1945, the Thunderbolt pilots flew their last combat mission over Germany. 7 days later, the Germans surrendered.
When a model of morality...
It's a great time in the history of this country, the Hoover years.
...becomes a bastion of hypocrisy.
One of the most evil men this America has ever produced.
Those on the trail of truth always get their man.
What a dreadful man.
An investigation of the man who ruled the FBI with an iron fist for 48 years.
Has exerted a great influence for good.
Specials presents J. Edgar Hoover on the History Channel.
New to National Geographic in 2004.
If you want punch, we've got plenty. If you want a kick out of life, you'll get it in Deadly Art.
All your favorite series return, from Tales of the Dead to Deadly Encounters. New episodes that will leave you awestruck.
This one's scary.
Reality TV at its most dangerous. Storm Stories, Mayday, Built for Destruction. Brand new, electrifying.
Pure, unadulterated pandemonium.
Better than being there.
National Geographic Presents returns with a new host, Aussie film icon Jack Thompson.
And an exciting new production retraces the steps of Marco Polo's groundbreaking adventures in the East.
All new in 2004, National Geographic Channel. Wherever you want to be,
we'll take you there.
Of space.
Men could follow where mice had been.
They didn't have rockets.
Space was a dirty word.
Or a NASA budget.
Dr. Stat was a visionary.
They wanted to get into space.
There were very few people who took space research seriously.
With virtually no money and little support, but with plenty of the right stuff.
Hey, that's an idea. I like that.
Specials presents Project Man High on the History Channel.
V-Day was a big relief, you know. And then you knew that you had a really good chance to get home. The problem was, during combat, every night when you go to bed, the prayer I would say is, just let me make it through tomorrow so I can thank you for that day tonight, because it was a one day at a time thing. And when we knew that it was over, it was a big relief. Of course, then we had another question right away. Will I be transferred to the Pacific? And some guys were, and some weren't.
While others celebrated on the streets of Paris, London, and New York, the Thunderbolt pilots still in Germany were quiet and reflective. Amazed that they were alive, yet horrified by the death, destruction, and misery all around them. The legacy of the most costly war in recorded human history. Hundreds of thousands of German war orphans were living on the streets as beggars, while millions of liberated refugees and concentration camp prisoners from all over Europe awaited transportation back to their homeland. Throughout the continent, defeated German soldiers would have to walk back to Germany.
German prisoners started to march through. There were hundreds and hundreds of German prisoners, and you could look the way their shoulders were sagging, their heads hunched over. They were a beaten army, and they just had no strength. Their morale was down to zero, and it was not a pretty sight to see. And there were so many, many amputees with either an arm missing or leg, heads bandaged.
Throughout the war, a fighter pilot did not see the face of his enemy, only the face of the country. The end of the war finally brought them face to face to see for the first time the people they had fought and the damage they had done from the air. In May 1945, defeated German soldiers, their columns stretching for miles, began their long march back to Germany from every corner of Europe. 6 million soldiers walking down the same roads and through the same towns they traveled as conquerors 5 years before. This time, not as the victors, but as the vanquished. A bitter end to a bitter war. A thousand-year Reich destroyed in less than a decade. The death toll in the Second World War was higher than any other war in recorded history, an estimated 55 million. The European war that ended on May 8, 1945, had been a total war on land, at sea, and in the air, fought by the armies, navies, and air forces of over 20 countries, waged mercilessly on civilians. For all the battles fought during these terrible war years, more civilians died in the conflict than soldiers. The defeated Germany these soldiers returned to was in ruins, and hardly a family had not suffered a loss. But the victory in the air came at a terrible price. 18,000 U.S. fighter planes and bombers were shot down over Europe, taking the lives of 80,000 pilots and crew. During the 5 years of raids on Germany, Allied airplanes dropped almost 3 million tons of bombs, killing 600,000 German civilians. 5 million houses were destroyed, leaving 20 million people homeless. The 50 largest German cities were reduced to hollow walls and rubble. Transportation and communication systems had ceased to function, as well as all levels of government. Hitler's total war brought Germany total destruction and shame for the crimes of the Nazis.
When you see the destruction at the end of the war, I mean, you can't believe how anyone could have done that and how anyone could have lived through it, you know? I mean, it's so complete destruction that it kind of boggles your mind to figure how people could have survived that, you know?
I miss the camaraderie, the action, the flying, the purposeness of missions, and the sudden ability to get something done. And I don't find that as much in peacetime. We were all friends with everybody in the squadron, and we had a feel of almost of brotherhood, because we were involved in exactly the same business, each of us. And the only thing that separated one from the other was length of time. How long were you able to stay alive? We trusted each other implicitly. There was never any even suggestion of someone who could not be trusted, or someone, in other words, I would put my life on the line for somebody else and they would do the same for me.
Long ago and far away, I dreamed a dream one day, and now that dream is here beside me. Long the skies were overcast, but now the clouds have passed.
In the conquest of the Reich, the Thunderbolt pilots of the 362nd Fighter Group flew over 3,000 combat missions.
Chills run up and down my spine.
For their bravery, the group was awarded a Presidential Unit Citation. But half of their pilots had been killed, captured, or wounded, and 48 Thunderbolts had been destroyed. The remaining planes were scrapped in the next months. Of the 15,000 made during the war, less than 10 are still flying today.
Atomic age. Man's ultimate weapons have threatened the world with Armageddon.
I wasn't thinking much about the bombs. I figured the bombs would go down with the airplane.
But there's another potent threat. Accidents.
You're supposed to let the bombs crash with the airplane.
Veterans who survived serious nuclear weapons accidents known as broken arrows share their experiences.
Broken arrow means serious nuclear weapons accident.
While the U.S. military insists that nuclear deterrent ensures peace, former Defense Secretary Robert S. McNamara disagrees.
It's a totally unacceptable risk.
Will the nuclear power's luck hold out as the world awaits the first broken arrow of the 21st century?
You only learn how complex technology fails when it fails.
America's Lost Bombs, the true story of broken arrows on the History Channel.
Just fantastic. You know, it's such a thrill to be able to climb in an aeroplane like the Wirrawee with the history that it has in Australian military aviation history. It's just a wonderful machine and it's a wonderful experience.
Tom Moon wasn't born when the Wirrawee helped defend Australia during the Second World War. But today, he's one of a handful of pilots who fly this historic aircraft at the Tamora Aviation Museum in southern New South Wales.
The Wirrawee is a very, very nice aeroplane if you treated it properly. If you abused it, it was a violent animal. It was a very, very nice aircraft. You couldn't break it.
Richard Boydell flew Wirrawees operationally with the RAAF in New Guinea during the war.
There were two people in it. It was admirably suited for the job we were doing, an army cooperation.
The Commonwealth Aircraft Corporation built 755 Wirrawees. They were built as a trainer. But in 1940, the RAAF was desperately short of fighters and bombers. And so the Wirrawee flew as an armed aircraft.
could carry two bombs. Its main problem in armament was the fact that it only had two machine guns as against the four and two cannons of the boomerang. We also had a single gun that the observer could fire out the back, but it was little more than a pea shooter. The Rilwaye was really a good aircraft for the work we did. It could photograph, it could bomb, it could strafe, it could do reconnaissance, it could do artillery spotting.
Once the Wirraway's in the air, it's a nice aeroplane to fly. It's nicely balanced. Performance-wise, you wouldn't call it the Ferrari of the sky, so you need to point it downhill and give it plenty of airspeed to get it to perform.
With a top speed of 350 kilometres per hour or 220 miles per hour, it was just too slow for air-to-air combat.
The engine is a Pratt & Whitney 600 horsepower. Not overpowered, it could do with another 600, but very reliable. You just push that handle forward and it makes this lovely radial noise. Inside the cockpit, the aeroplane's an ergonomic disaster area, straight after takeoff especially, because you have to retract the gear and push this lever at the same time. Make sure you've got sufficient airspeed, bring the power back and the prop governor back. Yeah, there's a lot of movement of hands going on at that particular time. Tail draggers are notoriously tricky to land, but the Wirraway is especially bad. It has quite a narrow undercarriage and it has a small rudder, so once it's in that three-point attitude, the rudder isn't very effective. In addition to that, the brakes are very tricky. They're very grabby, so if you apply brakes too early, it's not hard to tip it on its nose.
The steel tubing airframe is covered with doped fabric to reduce overall weight. The observer seat swivels to the rear, where a machine gun could be mounted. This Wirraway was delivered to the RAAF on Bougainville in 1945. But at the end of World War II, it was dismantled and then rebuilt in 1975. The Tamora Aviation Museum acquired the aircraft in 2000, and it forms part of the impressive historic military aircraft collection now housed at the Tamora Airport. It's airborne each month in the colours of 5 Squadron at the museum's flying weekends, appearing just as it did on Bougainville.
There she goes. That brings back some memories.
It's a chance for veteran Wirraway pilots to share their wartime stories too.
Every one of them must have been a superhero. The transition from the Tiger Moth to the Wirraway was after about 20 or 30 hours of flying. The Wirraway is not a high-performance aeroplane. It's not particularly fast nor manoeuvrable when compared to a combat aeroplane, and I just can't imagine how scary that would be.
Meet severe epileptic Jim Carella, who undergoes surgery to implant a pacemaker for his brain.
Everything that can be done was done to people with epilepsy.
The scientist who proved that epilepsy was not caused by possession by demons.
Everything imaginable. Exorcism, religious ceremonies.
The scientist who discerned localization of brain function.
In some ways, a philosopher whose philosophy was expressed through scientific experimentation.
The accident that led to the X-ray.
And there were no known rays or particles at that time to account for this.
The first doctor to map localization of brain function.
Trying to correlate structure with function.
The first implanted electrical pacemaker.
And this is the device itself with the battery and electronic components inside.
Maverick Medical Miracles.
And used as a mold for the entire device and empty shoe polish can.
The Brain on Medicine Month.
The following program is classified PG. The History Channel advised parental guidance is recommended for persons under 15 years.
The calm before the storm. For American pilots asleep at their bases in England, the calm would soon end.
All right, you guys. Breakfast at 3, briefing at 4.
February 3rd, 1945. Well, it was my 40th mission, so just like any other mission, you don't know what the target is until they wake you up around midnight or 2 in the morning to study the target, so.
4 a.m. Shortly before takeoff, the secret was unveiled. The target for the 8th Air Force that day was Berlin.
I knew that anytime you go to Berlin, it's a special mission. If we knocked out all the buildings that the German high command were occupying, including Hitler's place, wherever that happened to be, that it would call
to heel. But the experience of total collapse also produced new insights.
Der Krieg ging von Deutschland aus. Natürlich ist das ein Verbrechen, ganz gleich, wo das geschieht, ob das in Guernica oder in Dresden oder in Berlin oder Hamburg oder. Denn es sind ja wehrlose Zivilisten. Jetzt gerade wir Kinder. Ja. Wir sind doch völlig, völlig unschuldig. Und dort gab es doch wirklich keine Rettung. Also keine Möglichkeit der Gegenwehr. Oder das ist ein Verbrechen. Also das ist egal, wo das stattgefunden hat.
Graceful elliptical wing shape and distinctive Rolls-Royce Merlin engine sound, the Spitfire is an aircraft that arouses passions and stirs memories. It fought in the skies above Europe, Australia, and the Pacific. This aircraft is more than 60 years old. It lives here at the Tamora Aviation Museum in southern New South Wales. It's part of the collection of historic aircraft that make up Australia's military aviation heritage. And all are kept in flying condition. And whenever the Spitfire flies, people look up to marvel and remember.
Well, I think the Spitfire is the most recognised military aircraft that's ever been. There's a unique history to it. It's much more than just an aircraft.
David Lowy is the pilot of this, a Mark 8 Spitfire, the last Spitfire acquired by the Royal Australian Air Force. It's the only one left flying in Australia today. Top speed, 670 kilometres per hour.
You jump into this aeroplane and you just imagine that what young 20-year-old boys were doing 60 years ago, defending Australia, defending the UK.
It wears the camouflage colour scheme of number 457 Squadron, the Grey Nurse Squadron of the RAAF, operating out of Darwin and Moratai in 1944. The markings belong to Australian fighter ace Wing Commander Bobby Gibbs, one of Australia's World War II fighter aces. Today, he's come to see the Spitfire with another Australian fighter ace, Ted Sly.
I saw enemy aeroplanes in the air 63 times, and actually in that time I shot at aeroplanes on 38 occasions, and I didn't hit too much. I was not much of a shot.
But official records show that Gibbs was indeed an air ace, with 12 confirmed kills. So what was it like to fly into battle?
Well, I mean, if you're turning like that, you've got to pull inside him, and the deflection, you've got to assume that when your bullets go, that he flies into them. So, I mean, that's where the Spitfire was very good, because it could turn inside nearly all of the fighting aircraft.
The power and the voice of the Spitfire comes from the famous Rolls-Royce V12 Merlin engine. 27 litres with a two-stage supercharger. Hit the starter and all 1,700 horsepower comes to life. That's about four times the power of a Formula One car.
And it is a beautiful aircraft to fly. It's got a very nice roll rate. It's very sensitive in pitch, beautiful to aerobat, a huge amount of horsepower, and it's just an absolute delight to fly, and crowds love it.
The success of the Spitfire was its design. In 1934, Reginald Mitchell in England came up with the graceful and tight-turning elliptical wing. As well as piloting the Spitfire, David Lowy has brought the Tamora Aviation Museum from a personal dream to a reality that all now share.
Well, the museum represents part of Australia's history, part of our heritage, part of our military heritage. It represents the people that defended Australia in World War II, Korea and Vietnam.
Australia's only flying Spitfire is a tribute to the Australians who flew them.
I think for me, the greatest thrill of all in flying the aircraft is to fly it in front of people like that, who risked their lives in defence of Australia and defence of the UK. To see their faces after you land, it's what the whole thing's about, and I really get a great thrill out of doing that.
The following program is classified PG. The History Channel advise parental guidance is recommended for persons under 15 years.
In the early hours of June the 6th, 1944, Allied airborne troops began boarding the aircraft that were to take them to battle. As they dropped from the skies over Hitler's fortress Europe, these men had the grim satisfaction of being the first Allied troops to set foot on enemy-occupied soil. They were the vanguard of one of the largest military operations ever mounted.
Operation Overlord, the Allied campaign to liberate Northwest Europe, really had a double significance. Militarily, it represented the death knell for the German cause in the Second World War. But politically, it was also extremely important. Had the Allies either stumbled at the first hurdle on the 6th of June 1944, or at some time later on in the campaign, the map of Western Europe would have looked very different from that with which we're familiar with today.
From a technical point of view, though, Overlord is tremendously important because this was the first time that so many people and so much equipment was picked up and moved over the sea and dropped on shore against fierce opposition ever. Nobody had ever run an operation of this scale before.
The night of the 5th and 6th of June, 1944, the tension in Eisenhower's headquarters and the tension at number 10 Downing Street was absolutely incredible, because both Churchill and Eisenhower knew that there was a real possibility of this operation ending in total catastrophe. On the evening of the 5th of June, Eisenhower typed up two memoranda. One was to announce that D-Day had been successful, the other that D-Day had been a failure.
Today, as a memorial service is held for the paratroopers who helped secure the Normandy bridgehead, you can find amongst the headstones the grave of Private E.S. Corte. Sadly, he was among the first casualties in the great invasion of Europe. He had died to liberate Ranville, the first town in Europe to fall into Allied hands.
On this occasion, we'd got three airborne divisions. We'd got the British 6th Airborne Division and the American 101st and the 82nd. And they were going to drop on either side of the invasion pitches, the east and the west, left and the right.
The concept was fly the air landing brigade in and drop the parachute battalions in to take specific objectives to make it possible for the Allied landings to come in unmolested, for preventing the Germans from counterattacking over certain bridges. Certain bridges were knocked out to stop the Germans using them.
Even today, Operation Overlord still ranks as the largest and most complex single military operation ever staged. In the first wave, there were more than 75,000 Canadian and British troops and 57,000 Americans as they assaulted the beaches of Normandy. The code names of those beaches have become beacons in military history: Utah, Omaha, Gold, Juno, and Sword.
On D-Day, approximately 156,000 Allied troops landed from the sea or dropped from the air into Normandy. That's approximately five divisions coming ashore on the beaches with three brigades and a further three airborne divisions. Defending against them, it's very much harder to be certain of the exact size of the German forces, but added up, it comes out at about five divisions, one of them armored, plus a brigade. So in terms of land forces, the Allies are stronger, but not vastly stronger.
On the other side of the channel, the Germans knew that the invasion was coming. They had made considerable efforts to prepare what Hitler optimistically called the Atlantic Wall, a line of defenses intended to assure the protection of the coast from the Arctic to Spain. Work had actually begun on the Atlantic Wall in 1942. But by early 1944, it was still not complete. There were numerous concrete gun emplacements and blockhouses which dotted the coastline, but it was certainly not a continuous line. In late 1943, the famous desert veteran Erwin Rommel was personally appointed by Hitler as Inspector General of the Atlantic Wall defenses. One of the main elements of Rommel's defensive strategy lay in a massive belt of anti-tank mines along the entire length of the coast, which, in places, stretched to a depth of half a mile from the shoreline. This first line was intended to be backed up by an additional belt of mines up to 5 miles deep, sited further inland. Herr Paymoller was one of the men who helped set up the defenses.
Wir dann zu Kampfeinheiten zusammengestellt worden und kamen, da wurden demnach auch entsprechend raus geschickt, entweder in den Osten. Wir wurden seinerzeit erst nach Frankreich geschickt und machten dann die Küste da fest mit den Rommelspargeln. Gegen die Luftlandeversuche der Alliierten pflanzte man Baumstämme ein, in der Größe, ins Watt draußen, dass die Landungsboote nicht rankommen konnten. Und man verminte Strecken, exploding mines.
It has been calculated that this grandiose scheme would have required 200 million mines to complete. Despite the more limited resources actually available to him, Rommel still boasted that the beaches would become what he described as a zone of death.
The problem with the Atlantic Wall was the same as the problem with the Maginot Line. Once you get past the chain of fortifications, all of the effort and expenditure, all of those gun barrels that had been mounted in those fortresses, instantly become useless.
Nobody really expects defense lines to actually stop an attack dead. The defense lines are there to actually slow down the attack, you know, maybe by 24, 48 hours, something like that, to allow you to move your reserves up so you can then put in the counterattack.
When it came to the choice of the actual invasion beaches, the number of locations was limited by the availability of fighter cover which could be provided from England. An attack on Holland was also ruled out because of the difficulties of capturing a seaport. The logical choice, of course, was the Pas-de-Calais area, which was only 22 miles across the channel from Dover. This was also the shortest sea crossing. It was also obvious to the Germans, and it was here that the very heaviest defenses of Fortress Europe were concentrated. The final choice then fell upon the remaining option, which was the Normandy coast. Normandy was far enough from the obvious route to have a decoy effect on the Germans, but at the same time, it was still well within fighter range and was considerably less well defended than the Pas-de-Calais. Additionally, if Cherbourg could be captured early on, it would provide an invaluable port for bringing in the supplies which would be required for the massive body of men which would be necessary for the campaign in Europe.
Quite clearly, if one was going to supply such large numbers of personnel with all the diverse needs of 20th century armed forces, then an all-weather port facility was absolutely essential. Relying upon traffic across the beaches or relying upon the Mulberry harbours that the Allies constructed and took with them to Normandy was a partial recipe for logistics success, but certainly not a sufficient one.
As soon as he was appointed to Supreme Command, General Dwight D. Eisenhower set up his headquarters at Bushy Park in London's western suburbs, and gathered together the very best of Allied commanders that he could find. Air Chief Marshal Sir Arthur Tedder was the Deputy Supreme Commander. Air Chief Marshal Sir Trafford Lee Mallory was given command of Allied Air Forces, and Admiral Sir Bertram Ramsay was in charge of the sea forces for the invasion. On land, command fell to General Sir Bernard Montgomery, who was to command the forces on the ground. Inevitably, the colourful figure of Montgomery attracted a disproportionate level of interest. There was some controversy almost from the start of the operation. The initial plan had originally envisaged a three-division operation, which would have entailed landing around 100,000 Allied troops. For the cautious Montgomery, it soon became obvious that this would need to be revised to five divisions to guarantee success on D-Day. The overall plan for the invasion of Fortress Europe, codenamed Operation Overlord, called for the British and Canadian forces to seize the eastern beaches with the Caen Canal on their left flank. These beaches were codenamed Sword, Juno, and Gold. The bridge over the canal was to be seized in a bold airborne operation designed to protect the British left flank. Despite the best efforts of Hollywood to present Overlord as a purely American undertaking, the Americans were actually fewer in number than the British and Canadians, and therefore were to assault only two beaches in the west. These were codenamed Omaha and Utah. Once again, the American flank was to be protected by a parachute drop on the town of Saint-Mère-Église.
The Cold War between the former Soviet Union and the West had an unlikely battleground, the human brain.
In 5 weeks, I had 109 electroconvulsive shock treatments and mega doses of hallucinogenic drugs.
Without their knowledge and without their consent, test subjects underwent hypnosis, electroshock, and drug-induced hallucination.
There's been thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of people subjected to really damaging, unethical experimentation.
History's Mysteries presents Mind Control on the History Channel.
Is your garden spacious or space-challenged? Does it need a complete overhaul or just a gentle tweak?
It's more important to think about, is it appropriate for me, my garden, and the area that I live in?
Lifestyle's Brendan Moore makes spectacular gardens simple and unlocks the potential in your own piece of paradise.
So don't get intimidated. They just like a little bit of attention.
Want more? Get into more gardening.
It will be beautiful.
Thursday at 8, exclusive to Lifestyle.
In January, kickstart the new year with Animal Planet. The animal kingdom at its most bizarre, John Downer's Weird Nature. A look at the most perfect feline killers, Cats Gone Wild. The ultimate eight-legged killing machine, Spiders from Mars. Our most amazing and lethal animals, Australia Day Special. Animal Planet, it grabs you in January.
When a model of morality...
It's a great time in the history of this country, the Hoover years.
...becomes a bastion of hypocrisy.
One of the most evil men America has ever produced.
Those on the trail of truth always get their man.
What a dreadful man.
An investigation of the man who ruled the FBI with an iron fist for 48 years.
Has exerted a great influence for good.
Specials presents J. Edgar Hoover on the History Channel.
The planning for D-Day progressed carefully throughout 1943, and secrecy was vital.
If the Germans had got wind of it, even 48 hours beforehand, D-Day would have been a catastrophe. There would have been nothing to have prevented the Germans diverting their forces, very, very substantial forces in the Pas-de-Calais, to the Normandy area.
There was a huge deception plan to convince the Germans that the invasion was going to be in the Pas-de-Calais. Germans always believed it was going to be there, and we continued to allow them to think that way.
We did not know that we were going into Normandy until I was handed sealed orders on the ship in which I was before sailing.
As a direct result of the experience gained in the disastrous Dieppe raid in 1942, an ingenious variety of armored assault vehicles were designed to assist in the real attack on Hitler's Atlantic Wall. The most important of these was a special adaptation of the Churchill tank, which had its main gun replaced by a massive 290mm mortar known as a petard. This could fire a huge explosive charge known to the troops as the Flying Dustbin. The massive explosion was intended to blow apart concrete defences. For crossing larger obstacles such as sea walls, the Churchill tank could also be adapted to carry a box girder bridge with a span of 30 feet. In the event that the soft sand of the beaches would prove too difficult for tanks to cross, yet another variation on the Churchill was developed. This one carried what was known as a bobbin.
This was usually a huge roll of canvas or some similar material, often reinforced with bars of tubular steel, and it was wound around a drum, and this drum is then fixed onto the front of the tank. And in principle, what it could do was unreel this thing, drive over it as it went along, and leave a pathway behind it.
The Allies also developed two main variants of the trusty Sherman tank. The first of these was the duplex drive, or DD swimming tank. This used a collapsible canvas screen and a propeller mounted on the back of the tank to allow the vehicle to swim ashore and reach the shallow water, where they could neutralize enemy anti-tank positions. To clear a path through the minefields, there was a special variant of the Sherman known as the Crab. It was a flail tank which carried a mechanical device designed to beat the area in front of the tank, using steel chains which would explode any mines in the path of the vehicle. While Allied plans progressed smoothly, on the German side of the channel, the situation continued to deteriorate. As Supreme Commander, Adolf Hitler constantly dabbled in every aspect of the forces at his command. And he had a habit of reserving powerful formations for his personal control. As a result, the situation in France was a particularly complicated one. The nominal commander-in-chief was von Rundstedt, who controlled Army Group B, responsible for northern France and Belgium, and Army Group G, which was responsible for southern France. But Rommel, in command of Army Group B, enjoyed the favor of Hitler and had been appointed Inspector General of the entire Atlantic Wall defenses, with special responsibility for the entire coastal defense line. So, in practice, could not be overruled by von Rundstedt, even though von Rundstedt was his superior. To further complicate matters, three of the panzer divisions operating within Rommel's area of influence were allocated to a separate formation known as Panzer Group West. This powerful grouping was designated as an army reserve and could be deployed only on the express authority of Hitler himself.
Adolf Hitler believed in struggle, that the strongest man, the strongest beast, would emerge from a natural process of struggle, and he organized the Nazi state that way, so that the German command structure is not set up to cooperate with itself. It is set up as a series of competing structures which are meant to fight each other. And they did this so well that they defeated themselves as well as the Allies defeating them in Normandy.
Rommel believed that the only chance for defeating the Allied invasion was to fight on the beaches and drive the invasion back into the sea. Rommel therefore wanted the armored reserves as close to the beaches as possible for a quick counterattack. Von Rundstedt, however, disagreed with Rommel's strategy.
Rundstedt reacted to the threat of Allied invasion in Normandy in a sound, conventional German staff college way. Let the Allies come ashore, let them get inland where they can be encircled, and then destroyed in the traditional German battle of annihilation. And Rundstedt's concept required that the armor be held back, far away from the beach, so that once the Allies are ashore, they can be punched with a heavy fist of armor. Now, Rommel disagreed fundamentally. He
He said, Rundstedt, you don't understand that if you don't have air superiority, you cannot count on being able to have that big battle of annihilation. Without air superiority, for instance, that big armored fist of yours is going to be destroyed on the railway tracks back in Paris by Allied air. You can't do it, says Rommel.
The struggles in the Wehrmacht hierarchy were merely the start of the problems for the Germans on D-Day. The German forces, already thinly spread, were further weakened by the needs of the Russian front. Hitler constantly took German divisions away from the task of defending the Atlantic Wall to shore up the crumbling front in the east.
From 1941 through to 1944, about two-thirds of all the German warfighting resources were being tied up in the war against the Soviet Union.
In consequence, many of the divisions which were dispatched to the Atlantic Wall were poor quality, and in some cases, actually comprised of troops who would otherwise have been considered unfit for service. Although the German forces could deploy a small number of highly experienced, well-supplied divisions, they also had a large number of units which were under strength, poorly equipped, with poor transport. As much as 10% of Rommel's Army Group B was not even composed of German nationals. In the front lines on D-Day, the proportion of non-Germans may have been as high as 25%. These were men who were volunteers from various countries occupied by the Germans or prisoners of war who had enlisted in the German army. They came mainly from the Asiatic republics of the Soviet Union and were simply used as cannon fodder in the front line of D-Day. The momentous decision of which day to choose for D-Day rested on the shoulders of the Supreme Allied Commander, General Dwight D. Eisenhower. He originally selected D-Day as the 5th of June, the day when the tides best suited the invasion. During the D-Day landings, and for up to 20 miles inland, the Allied forces could rely on the massive guns of the Allied battleships, which were capable of firing devastating barrages of heavy artillery fire against the German forces.
5:35 o'clock, and to 800 warships, the signal, commence bombardment, sweep the beaches.
In the opening days of the Normandy campaign, the Allies could rely upon the support of 9 battleships, 23 cruisers, and 73 destroyers.
D-Day bombardment, and tired gun crews await the next barrage.
Cyril Timms was aboard the Allied fleet as the bombardment began. More than 55 years later, he can still vividly recall the effects of the shelling.
We were bombarding Normandy. We were anchored off Le Havre. And we were bombarding 20 miles inland, a place called Calm. And we were being controlled, gunnery-wise, by a spotter plane 20 miles away. I don't know what the Germans thought, I'm sure. But it certainly roused them up when we put a few shells amongst them.
For the Egyptians, there was an afterlife to prepare for.
The tomb chapel becomes a kind of miniature cosmos all by itself.
How does their view of death differ from others?
It's extraordinary that this idea of life and death was not as separate at all as it is in modern day.
Egypt, Land of the Gods presents Death and Rebirth on the History Channel.
You can put a Land Rover Discovery to just about any test. On road, off road. Crossing logs or rivers. Up hills or down and dirty. Right now is a great time to put a Land Rover retailer to the test with great deals on 03 Discovery while stocks last. The Discovery Challenge. Put us to the test.
History Channel International presents International Dateline.
In 1942, at Bataan in the Philippines, in the greatest defeat of the Allied forces, 76,000 servicemen under Allied command surrendered to the Japanese. At the Battle of Leningrad, troops from the Soviet Union began a major counteroffensive against invading Germany. And in a secret lab at the University of Chicago, Italian physicist Enrico Fermi achieved the first sustained nuclear reaction.
They hold secrets of lost civilizations.
The sight is absolutely breathtaking.
Open tombs that reveal mysteries of life and death.
There are always people who love forbidden things.
Secret Passages presents Death on the History Channel.
One other area where the Allies enjoyed undisputed superiority was in air power. From April 1944, they had been conducting bombing operations against French targets, including railway marshalling yards and bridges. On D-Day itself, 5,000 Allied fighters filled the sky and swept away the 119 German fighters which opposed them. With the air superiority of 50-1, rocket-firing Typhoons of the Allied Air Force had a field day, combing the terrain behind the Normandy beaches for any sign of movement on the ground. By midday on June the 6th, 1944, Allied fighters were completely unopposed, and in many instances, the pilots could no longer find a target. Allied air superiority naturally affected the whole conduct of the battle. It meant that German reinforcements were slow getting to Normandy.
Allied air superiority meant that once the Germans realised that the main invasion was in Normandy, they had then got to start moving their army, their panzer divisions, up to Normandy. Allied air superiority was going to prevent that, or certainly help to prevent that, because the Germans found themselves in the predicament of having to move troops and tanks by night. If they moved by day, they were just taken out by the Typhoons and the American fighters, the tank busters.
I remember once we went out on a recce where the railway crossed the road, the railway crossing, and four Panther tanks had been knocked out by Typhoons. And they were on the railway line, they'd been travelling up the railway line. And they were really wicked, those Typhoon rockets. We used to sort of give up a cheer every time the Typhoons came.
Newsreels of the period show German vehicles covered in branches in an attempt to disguise any vehicle movements from the air. The crews constantly scanned the horizon for the first signs of the British fighter bombers, which made any movement on the ground an extremely hazardous undertaking. To offset the many disadvantages which faced the German troops fighting on the ground in Normandy, they did enjoy some real advantages over the Allies in terms of experience. Many of the panzer divisions, which would be used to face the Allies, had a strong core of battle-hardened, experienced troops who had already seen 4 years of brutal warfare. This experience gave them the mental toughness which would serve them in great stead during the coming battle. In among these divisions were some very formidable formations, such as the SS Leibstandarte and the Panzer Lehr Division.
The Leibstandarte Adolf Hitler, the 1st SS Panzer Division, was a formation which, like other SS units, was very, very well stocked. Because the SS had its own chain of command, and because Heinrich Himmler was so close to Hitler and so personally powerful, the SS divisions, like the Leibstandarte Adolf Hitler, were very well supplied with people. They were very well supplied with tanks, well fed, well fueled, compared to the rest of the German army.
Like so many of the German armoured formations committed to the fighting in Normandy, the Panzer Lehr, or Demonstration Division, was an extremely capable fighting formation. It was well equipped with something like 200 tanks, many of them modern Panthers, which were probably superior to most of the Allied tanks at that time. In addition, it was made up of personnel
drawn primarily from training establishments. So these were officer and NCO cadres and specialists who had extremely prolonged experience on fighting on, for example, the Eastern Front. So these were very capable personnel.
Brigadeführer Witt, der Kommandeur der SS-Division Hitlerjugend.
The Hitler Youth Division was virtually unique in the history of warfare. It was composed of utterly fanatical, ideologically dedicated young Nazis with an average age of 18.
This division was formed in October 1943, and it was known as the Hitler Youth Division, the 12th SS Panzer Division, as it became. And it was an exceedingly dangerous division because it was composed of young men who were fanatics, and young men of 16 and 17 who could not conceive of death. Not only are they fearless, but when they are fighting for a cause that they believe in, men of that age can be utterly ruthless. They have no capacity to empathize.
One area in which the Germans had a real advantage was in the quality of their tanks. Not only were the crews hugely experienced and battle-hardened by years on the Russian front, the tanks themselves were far better than those used by the Allies. In particular, the Tiger, Panther, and the new King Tiger tanks could all engage Allied tanks at much longer ranges than those at which the Allies could fight back.
The German tanks came from the German tradition of precision engineering and excellent design. And they were technically brilliant, the German tanks. And by 1944, many of them were armed with 88mm high-velocity guns, which could punch through Allied tanks like a hot knife through butter.
If one talks to a veteran of the Northwest European campaign today and ask them questions about their armor and the quality of their armor, you're likely to get a very, very angry response indeed. And I have actually seen veterans at conferences get up and say that the manufacturers of British tanks who received medals at the end of the Second World War, if they'd had any decency at all, would have actually sent their medals back.
On June the 1st, when the first meeting to discuss the weather forecast for D-Day was held, the outlook was not good, and it deteriorated during the next 3 days. Finally, at 4:15 a.m., after much deliberation, the order was given to postpone the invasion until June the 6th. Harvey Pearman recalls the uncertainty which surrounded the decision to go.
They put us on the boats a couple of days before, and then they postponed the landings, and we were rolling about on these landing craft for a couple of days before they decided to take off because of the weather. And when we got out in the channel, there was minesweepers on each side of us, escorting us over to Normandy. And I think we were on the landing craft about nearly 24 hours on the crossing, which is about 100 miles across to Normandy from Southampton.
H hour in the British sector was fixed at 7:25 a.m. on June the 6th, with the U.S. forces in the Western sector going in 50 minutes earlier at 6:35 a.m. In the early hours of the morning, the drone of aircraft engines could be heard overhead. About 750 heavy bombers carried out a concentrated bombing attack designed to soften up the German positions in the coastal area. As dawn broke on D-Day, the fires started by the heavy bombers acted like beacons for the incoming ships. The coast of France was clearly visible when the heaviest air blow of all was struck immediately before H hour. Flying fortresses and liberators of the US 8th and 9th Air Forces, covered by an umbrella of fighters, unloaded 2,000 tons of bombs on the British and American beaches. The complete absence of the Luftwaffe at this time must have been grimly suggestive to the stunned German defenders of things to come. One of those who could not stand the strain was a German artilleryman, Herr Hesselbart. He quickly surrendered to the Allies on D-Day.
Ein Angriff von 1500 amerikanischen fliegenden Festungen. Und ich habe nie auch nur eine einzige deutsche Maschine am Himmel gesehen. Man kann eine gewisse, durch eine gewisse Tapferkeit besserer Ausbildung kann man eine Überlegenheit ausgleichen. Wenn diese Überlegenheit aber so riesengroß war, dann kann man nichts machen. Und am nächsten Tag sind die Amerikaner dann zum Angriff angetreten und an diesem Tag hatte ich Gelegenheit überzulaufen. Und das war dieses Schlimme, dieses Gefühl, hoffentlich fällt da jetzt keiner auf deinen Kopf. Und das war das Schlimmste.
Herr Hesselbert was not the only one with problems that day. The German 7th Army came under the command of General Dollmann, but he himself was absent from the invasion area on June the 6th at a planning meeting. To further complicate matters, Rommel, his direct superior, had also chosen this precise time to go home on leave to visit his wife. With Hitler retaining personal control of Panzer Group West, the net effect of the confusion was that only the 21st Panzer Division was available to perform a counterattack against the Allies on June the 6th.
The big armored counterattack force that the Germans had in France was in the hands of the Führer. And everybody knew that the Führer didn't like being woken up in the middle of the night. And when it came time to actually use the armored counterattack force, nobody would go in to wake the Führer. And as a result, the Germans could not put their armored counterattack in a timely fashion.
Once the bombers had done their work, the bombarding ships opened up. British Hunt-class destroyers raced in to engage in close duels with any surviving shore batteries. The final close-up punch before the assault troops poured ashore was delivered by rocket-firing craft. Despite the massive advantages, the Allies did not have everything their own way. Along the entire 50-mile front, appalling weather hampered the landings. Enemy fire from bold survivors added to the confusion.
They kept massive files on famous celebrities like Frank Sinatra, Marilyn Monroe, John Lennon. Some of the information was true. Much more was wild rumor.
Basically, he's a big smut pile.
It was as though FBI boss J. Edgar Hoover was obsessed with the private lives of America's biggest stars.
This was a form of titillation for him.
They assumed nobody else would ever see these files.
History's Mysteries presents the FBI Celebrity Files on the History Channel.
Having your own place at the beach? Priceless. Use your MasterCard from now to January 11 for your chance to win $250,000 towards your own beach house. For other great holiday prizes, visit the website.
Bill Hunter again. Up there, Kazawi. Australian rules football was devised by Thomas Wills and Henry Harrison as a winter game to keep cricketers fit. What's regarded as the first match was played between Melbourne Grammar School and the Scots College on August 7, 1858. It was a mixture of rules, played with 40 a side, and lasts from noon until dark.
The final chapter of a British legend.
Okay.
For over over 34 years, the crash had remained shrouded in mystery.
You know, it came as a complete and utter shock.
Now Coniston Water yields up its secret.
You simply didn't expect that what did happen was ever going to happen.
Ending a 30-year search.
I've been absolutely determined to find this wreck. It's become something of a personal obsession.
Specials presents The Search for Bluebird on the History Channel.
The hardest fighting on the whole length of the beaches came in the American sector and on Omaha Beach in particular. The American Omaha landings began to go wrong from the very start. The attacking forces which made the assault, the 16th Regimental Combat Team 1st Division and the 116th Regimental Combat Team 29th Division, were confronted by violently rough seas and hidden underwater obstacles which tore many landing craft apart. Lashed by huge waves and withering German shellfire, only two of the 32 amphibious tanks launched actually made Omaha Beach.
The most spectacular failure were the swimming tanks, the DD tanks. On certain sectors, and I would cite particularly off some of the American beaches, they launched too far out, they launched into very bad seas and a crosswind, whereas the British and Canadians were heading straight into it, and they certainly lost a lot of tanks and a lot of men.
By one of the few strokes of misfortune that befell the Allies on that fateful day, the Americans found themselves confronted by strong and determined German forces ranged along the top of the high bluffs which overlooked the beach.
Omaha Beach was a very difficult beach to land on. A lot of the other beaches in Normandy were being defended by low-grade German troops. However, there was a veteran unit which had been sent to the area, the 352 Infantry Division. And the 352 Infantry Division were good quality troops. They were veterans of operations in Italy. And they had been sent to Normandy, to a quiet area, to recuperate and build up more combat strength. And it just happened that on the day that the Americans land on Omaha Beach, they were doing an exercise. And the exercise was, everybody prepare for an invasion by the British, Canadians and Americans.
The chaps who were coming ashore in the landing craft were put out to sea, something like 12 miles out to sea. That was 3 hours in a landing craft, a flat-bottomed boat. Men were violently sick, they were violently ill, they were terrified, they were frightened. As they got closer inshore, things got worse, and the Germans were just sitting on the bluffs above Omaha Beach. And the Germans never fired a shot until the landing craft came into shore. When the ramps dropped, the Germans opened fire.
It was obvious to ships lying offshore that some very hard fighting was going on, and that the Americans were finding it very difficult to get a foothold.
The battle on Omaha Beach on the 6th of June appeared to be going so badly by lunchtime that Omar Bradley, who was on a command vessel further out in the Bay of the Seine, actually came very close to ordering the attack on Omaha to be suspended. If this had happened, there would have been a great gap in the Allied invasion front between Utah Beach, where the American 4th Division had landed very successfully, and the Anglo-Canadian beaches much further to the east.
Finally, two British destroyers moved in close to pound the German positions, and the beleaguered troops were able to move off the beach. But this victory had been achieved at a fearful cost. Over 4,000 dead and wounded troops were left behind. On the extreme flank of the Allied landings at Utah Beach, the Americans enjoyed considerably more success, although, ironically, it started with what was potentially the seeds of failure. As the hundreds of craft made for the shore hidden by a smokescreen, they were intended to be shepherded by patrol craft PC 1176, which would guide them to the appropriate beach. Unfortunately, the patrol craft hit a mine and was completely destroyed. As the other craft carried on to the shore, they drifted into an offshore current and were carried downstream, 2 kilometers too far to the south. Fortunately, this mishap actually turned out to be a blessing in disguise. Once ashore, Brigadier General Theodore Roosevelt Jr., the son of the president, soon realized that the beach that he had landed on was far less defended than the beach which had originally been assigned to them. Roosevelt urged the troops to move as quickly as possible inshore to overcome the light German defenses. In a sector which had been expected to cost many lives, the 8th and 22nd Infantry Regiments lost only 12 men. Beaten and battered by the elements they may have been, but the men of the US 4th Infantry Division on Operation Overlord's westernmost beach were able to link up with the troops of the 101st Airborne Division at a cost of fewer than 280 casualties. By this stage, the American 101st Airborne needed help. Rommel had ordered that any likely drop areas in the immediate vicinity of Carentown were to be flooded.
When the airborne troops did land, they were so loaded down with equipment that when they landed in the swamps of the Cotentin Peninsula, a lot of them were weighed down by their equipment and they drowned because they were unable to pull themselves out of the swamp. And because they were so scattered across the French countryside, their buddies weren't there to help them.
In addition, possible drop zones were heavily sown with anti-personnel mines, which also caused heavy casualties among the American paratroopers. The Canadian and British troops who began the invasion in the center of Gold Beach at 0725 hours were met by elements of the 716th German Static Division, a numerically inferior and poor quality outfit, which were no match for the highly motivated Allied troops. The British 231st Brigade Group and 69th Brigade Group of the 50th Division, however, met ferocious opposition from elements of the veteran German 352nd Division. Inevitably, some pockets of German resistance escaped the amazing bombardment because many of the concrete pillboxes went deep underground. At many points, therefore, the dash across the sands had to be made in the face of rifle and machine gun fire. It was afternoon before the German guns, having resisted all infantry assaults, were silenced by Allied artillery. It took the entire day for the Allies to secure their position on the Gold beachhead. By nightfall, the British attacks had managed to push inland for a distance of approximately 5 miles. At Juno Beach, an offshore shoal delayed the landings by 7th Brigade Group and 8th Brigade Group of the 3rd Canadian Division by 10 minutes. The rough seas hurled the Canadian troops onto the beachhead, which had been reduced by the very high tide to only 100 yards wide at its narrowest point. Treacherous rocks and reefs were also a constant danger to the assault craft, which exploded with alarming regularity. After much hard fighting against the German 736th Grenadier Regiment, the Canadians made steady progress, and the afternoon saw the 3rd Canadian Division and the 50th Division firmly established ashore.
In Normandy landings on D-Day, I was attached to the 3rd Canadian Division, and we were landing the troops, the Canadians, on the beaches. And, when we got there, there were a lot of Canadians. They'd fought their way ashore and, you know, that sort of thing, and we dropped them. We came on like the second tide, and a lot of the bodies were still on the beach with their hands sticking out of the sand, you know, and we kind of had to move them, otherwise we'd have run over. Well, some of them was run over, you know.
With all objectives achieved, the way had been paved for the leading elements of the British 7th Armored Division, the famous Desert Rats, to make their landings on Juno Beach during the late afternoon of 6th of June. On Sword Beach, The landings were preceded by a British action which led to the famous battle at Pegasus Bridge.
What we had to do at Pegasus Bridge, well, was to get a force of paratroopers or air landing soldiers directly onto the bridge to seize it, to actually prevent German reserves from moving up from the southeast and crossing the Orne.
Now bear in mind, paratroopers have already dropped and they're fighting out on the flanks. They have to be reinforced. You have to get men to them, you have to get supplies to them, and you have to get reinforcements to them. And it was necessary to capture these two bridges intact so that the seaborne troops would come inland and very quickly link up with the airborne troops.
The glider-borne troops of 6th Airborne Division managed to land their gliders almost on the bridge. They landed on the east bank of the bridge, right up beside the bridge abutments. And as a result, they could just walk right onto the bridge and hold it so that when the Germans counterattacked, the British troops were already there holding the bridge and the British left flank was safe.
On Sword Beach, the British 8th Brigade group of 3rd Division landed amid the chaos with orders to link up with the 6th Airborne Division at Pegasus Bridge and to advance more than 10 miles inland to capture and secure the strategically vital city of Caen. This objective was to be achieved within the first day of the D-Day landings. Their progress was slowed by the ever-growing numbers of men and armored vehicles on the narrow beaches struggling to break out into the open country beyond. Determined German resistance and the swell of the seas further delayed the Allied advance. To make matters worse, they were also met by tanks and infantry of the 21st Panzer Division, part of Rommel's Army Group B Reserve, which had been thought by Allied intelligence to be in a different part of Normandy.
The 21st Panzer Division represented the only substantial armoured reserve available to the Germans on the 6th of June 1944, and its counterattack potential was quite significant. However, its counterattacks were very badly mismanaged. Orders were countermanded, the initial deployment of the division was rather poor and spread out, so that when the attacks did finally go in on the afternoon and early evening of the 6th of June, they went in a rather sporadic, ineffectual, unconcentrated fashion.
However, a battle group from the 21st Panzer Division did manage to exploit a gap between the British and Canadian forces and actually reached the coast at Lyon-sur-Mer at around 7 o'clock on the evening of June the 6th. No reinforcements, however, were available, and the German forces were forced to fall back to positions just north of Caen. The fighting on that day had cost the division 25% of its tanks, and there was worse to follow. Caen, of course, had been an objective for D-Day itself, and at this stage, no one could possibly have suspected that it would take another 6 weeks before the town fell into Allied hands. But the main objective for D-Day had been achieved. The Allied army was ashore. The writing was now on the wall for Hitler's thousand-year Reich.
Citizens was relatively minor. Many shelters fell in empty space, in the street, in parks. Although it was an extraordinary technical feat for the time, its military effectiveness was virtually nil.
Gradually, the introduction of new weapons such as the tank and the airplane helped restore mobility to the battlefield. As soon as these new inventions arrived, the artillery units of both sides began to counter them. At first, existing guns like the French 75, the German 77mm field gun, and the Russian 76mm Putilov were simply placed on special mounts to fire at planes or used at low trajectories